No one can say that Christ Jesus is their ruler, that Christ Jesus is their master, that Christ Jesus is Lord, in other words, their Lord, their personal Lord. He's my master, he's my ruler, he rules over me, but by the Holy Ghost, because it's the Holy Spirit that brings to us such a life, such a privilege, such a relationship. Hallelujah. And out of that expression of the same lordship and that same expression that we have there by the Holy Ghost to say Christ Jesus is master, ruler, Lord, so comes forth all the other wonderful expressions of heaven. The wonderful expressions of the nature of God and the life of God, His love, His peace, His joy, His goodness. There also comes forth the glorious display of His power to be able to deal with every power of darkness, every stronghold, everything that would oppose the purposes and will of God, everything that tries to stand in the way of God's blessing, whether it comes in the form of sickness or disease or sin or torment or oppression. Power! Power over all the works of the devil. What a lie. Somebody said, well, if God was really God and really loved us, why would He allow all these things to go on? He's allowing a certain amount of things to go on just to reach you. But having reached us, now He's given us the authority to put it to a stop. Huh? So why don't you get busy? Hallelujah. Quit sitting around wondering, why don't you just get busy? Because Christ Jesus was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. And He wants to be manifested in you and me. He's come to be revealed in our lives. He's come to be made known. He gave us power from on high that we may be witnesses, those who could testify to His living power, that He rose up from the dead and dwells in us. You know, a witness, one who can prove, a proof provider. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. A martyrus, one who has given their life over in exchange for another life, or have laid their life down. But in this particular instance, the Greek word martyrus refers to an exchange of our life for Him. We laid down our life and took up His life. Hallelujah. Woo, and what an abundant life and a blessed life it is. Well, praise God. You may not fully understand that, but that's okay. Hang around. You know, we're always making decisions. People made decisions not to be here tonight. It is amazing to me why there would be people that, you know, I mean, some people even email me and tell me different things, that how they wanted to learn more and get more and have more in God. But you know what? If you're making decisions all the time whether or not you're going to have all of that. People make a decision not to come to the meeting because they prioritize that. You can be seated and think, well, it doesn't mean that much. Oh, see, the thing about it is, as you step into a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, it means a whole lot. All of a sudden, you begin to understand the sacredness of His house. Church isn't in a social club anymore. It's not an event. There's been so much merchandising, so much commercializing. There's been so much of men, such an entertainment center. It's got to be, you know, running a race so much in so many respects with, you know, what people try to do for you and show you on television and the movies. You know, otherwise, it just, you know, it just doesn't have a relevance. Well, there's something far greater than what happens in the realms of your senses. And that which you see with your eye and hear with your ears and feel with your hands. The senses, there's so much more going on. God and the Holy Ghost has come to make alive every dimension of our spiritual life so that we can begin to behold the unseen, to see the unseen. And tonight I'm going to talk to you about seeing the unseen. Hallelujah. Tonight I'm going to talk to you about Jesus being fully revealed in your life and what you're going to have to do. Huh? Every time something happens that upsets you, listen to me. Every time something happens that upsets you, you know what's happening? God's just showing you that, you know, you're going to have to stop doing what it is you want to do and start participating with what it is He wants to do. Hallelujah. God, the Holy Ghost, wants to ignite you with the fire of His presence. Such a fire that only comes out of an intimacy with Him. People want to have a fire of God that's a church meeting fire. You know, church meeting, then jump around, you know, dance around, live in the Spirit. Fire. No, the Lord wants to nurture within our life a great anointing, a manifest presence of His glory through an intimacy with Him, through a walk with Him that happens every second of the day, every minute of the day. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. That place where you're always there looking for him, standing there in the midst of the congregation. I know where I'm at. I'm in a place because it's so sacred that God has called it the very revelation of Jesus, the body of Christ, the fullness of his power, his church, the assembly. I'm looking for Jesus right now, standing in the midst of his congregation. When I go to pray, when I start praying, I mean, he's so near to me, I can almost touch him. When I start worshiping, he almost becomes visible to me. When I start reading his word and feasting upon his word, hallelujah, looking at all the promises of God, and all those things that men did as they interacted with him, the atmosphere changes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The name of Jesus becomes powerful through you and in your mouth and on your lips. And the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ becomes ever more so powerful and life-changing because of the impact that he's had on you, because of how captivated you are with him. You want a greater anointing? Get captivated with Jesus. Not in 2 hours a week. 2 days a week. Let the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit has come to lead you and guide you, and he's come to lead you and guide you into all that Jesus is, to come and reveal Jesus to us. Papa just wanted you to come walk in the Spirit and quit having all these ambitions. Oh, I want to be this and I want to do that. Forget about that nonsense. Don't you want Jesus?
Yes.
Why don't you just have him? Let him decide what you can do. Amen. What you can be. Hallelujah. Come on now. Because I want to talk to you tonight about going into a relationship with him where he empowers you to begin to ask of him things that you don't even know you have a right to do it. In other words, he's laid hold on you so that you will lay hold on him. Listen to me. God initiated it when he jumped out from behind the bushes and grabbed Jacob. He laid hold on Jacob so that Jacob in turn could lay hold on him and not let go. Father is coming into our lives. Christ Jesus is coming to our lives. Beyond all that you can even imagine or think or ask. God the Holy Ghost has come into our lives to take us all the way over into the realms of boldness and confidence and certainty. I'm going to talk to you tonight about how the anointing will just get you in a mess of trouble. How the life of Jesus will just get you in a mess of trouble.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you find yourself in that mess of trouble and the sufferings of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then through that, what happens is you just go deeper into dependency upon him, go deeper into a commitment and consecration to him. You allow greater affection and love to work in you that creates a greater boldness and a greater confidence that gets you into more trouble. That then works another cycle of the whole thing. Hallelujah. Oh yeah, you get ready because I'm going to tell you, I'm laying on you thick here tonight. I promise you, we're going to get it. Hallelujah. We'll get you tonight into a place, we pray in Jesus' name, that you'll understand that you're in a transition. At this very moment, you're in a transition. God is phasing out a period of time in which Satan has been allowed to deceive men and work all kinds of wickedness through men's very lives, through their hands, their mouth, their mind, their bodies, their beings. That's being phased out. The kingdom of God is rushing in and pressing strong upon all humanity and all God's creation. And it's about to explode in the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's very near. It's about to explode into a great display of the power of God, and all that belongs to darkness is about to be contained in a place and never be able to escape again. It's about to be contained and sealed up in a place called a place called the lake of fire and eternity without God. We're right now in the transition. Some people don't know that. to look at many of God's people, it surely doesn't show, because they all wrapped up in what's going on in this life right now. But we want you to understand, Jesus said it. He stood up and said, listen, I'm going to tell you the most important thing for your life. You got to understand this. You ask me the question, what's the most important thing? You ask me, what do you need to do above everything else? I'm going to tell you what you need to do. You better get serious. You better get hungry. You better get thirsty. You better seek passionately. You better go after, lay hold of the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Because right now, you at the transition where everything is about to be phased out. And then the heaven and the earth is going to be burned up with a fervent heat. God's going to create a new heaven, new earth, after that Jesus Christ comes and rules for 1,000 years. I know many things about this transition, this phasing out period of time, because I know the upheaval that is going to take place in the earth. I know pretty much, I've got a pretty good idea, and I've tried my best to paint a picture for people of what the earth looks like 3.5 years into the tribulation, and then what it looks like at the end of the tribulation, where more than 50% of the humanity has been destroyed from off the face of the earth. There is no mountains. There are no islands of the sea. There is complete devastation, complete turmoil, where the place that everything has come to, it's been completely, entirely rearranged. I don't believe that there's a single building standing. By the time at the end of the tribulation, the time of the Armageddon, what's going to happen, the time when men come up to fight against God, there is nothing really left but just wooden shields, swords, not even metal shields, wooden shields, arrows, bows, swords, all pretty much which can be burned for fuel. For the prophet Isaiah said they will not need to take fuel from the wood for 7 years because of the abundance of the weaponry left there in the battle. I mean, it's just so literal. People don't realize. They think that everything's going to go on just as it is. No, it's not. I mean, it's just, look, you know, the chaos and the evil sits right there, always there, almost as it were, right at the very, you know, right at the very door of our lives. And Father in his mercy just holds it back. He holds it back. He's got a transition going on. He's got a harvest that he wants to bring in. He's got people, there's 3 billion people on the planet right now that have never heard. I'm going to talk to you about a preacher who went into the unreached people groups, and everybody that he saw hated the name of Jesus, hated the idea that he was a Jew and that he was coming preaching this new religion, preaching this new faith. So that everywhere that he went, he was thrown in jail, he was beaten, he was persecuted. Every place he found himself, the more he preached, the more trouble that he got into. And of course, you know who I'm talking about. I'm talking about the one who is the example for us of what it means to follow Jesus. His name is Paul. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you, I want to see some people here tonight begin to take a hold of the things of God so that you begin to live as though you are actually part of that transition that is taking place. You're the ground troops of heaven lit with the authority of God, the evangel flame of the Holy Ghost, to go and reach a lost and dying world. Many will not hear, but there's some will hear. Many will persecute you, but there are those, maybe 1 in 1,000. Look, what's the value of 1 in 1,000? Could you take a beating for 1 in 1,000? Could you take stripe imprisonment for 1 in 1,000? Somebody said you can't go to the Kashmir Valley, you'll be killed. Well, if I go to the Kashmir Valley and I get killed, my blood will pave the way for more to come. If I go to Kashmir Valley and I don't get killed, then I'll see a great revival take place. So either way, I've won. Huh? And when all of a sudden you become more than just patty cake, little baby school Christian, and you step into walking with God, all of a sudden you recognize, wait a minute, man, I'm not going to sit around anymore when God has called me to be a part of this glorious kingdom and to announce his glory and announce his fame with the authority of heaven, and it has an impact for all eternity. I'm not going to be in the nosebleed section. I'm not standing in the back of the line. I'll be right up in front. Come on, people. And we're inviting you because God has invited you. You say, well, what can I do? I tell you what you can do. You can begin to trust in God and obey God. And when you begin to trust God and obey God, supernatural miracles begin to take place on your behalf. A lot of people don't even ever get into the program because they got some little ditty of a vision in the kingdom of God that the Lord didn't even come up with. You know what I'm saying? God's got great plans for you. Come on now, people. Be dissatisfied. I got me. I'm going to tell you right now, you can do anything to Americans, Christian Americans, but don't take their TV and refrigerator away. Then they're going to be all up in arms. I mean, we're going to have a little bit more stamina, a little bit more purpose, you know, a little bit more value in who God has made us than that. Father wants to stir some passion in us. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. So I want you to open your Bible, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm going to give you some radical stuff. I'm going to download some radical stuff to you and leave you in shock. And then I'll come back and help you understand a little bit more about what it means. I just want you to recognize that this is just the average, standard, everyday life of a person that's obeying God. You ready? This isn't just some kind of unique person, this spectacular, doesn't really have any relationship to us. Listen, if Paul's life has no relationship to your life, then none of the power and the glory and the gospel that he described has any relationship to your life either. So that's just all nonsense. Of course his life has a relationship to us. Everybody in the New Church, look, just about everybody in the New Testament church when all this began got killed for Jesus. If they didn't get killed, they got severely beat to death. Hello. And it went on that way until modern times. And now everybody's getting all up in arms, our safety, all concerned for their human life. I don't want to read 2 Corinthians chapter 8, 4 yet. I just got hit with Romans 8, 36. I know you know that verse scripture. I know you know that verse scripture because you memorized that one. You know, that's one of the things that really is highlight to you, right? Yeah, right. Okay, turn over there. Romans 8, 36, okay? Romans 8, 36. Everybody rejoices in this. As it is written, for your sake we are killed all the day long and accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yeah, everybody's glorying in that one. Woo-hoo, praise God. But that's who we are. We are the savor of death. We just smell like death to those who don't believe. We're not supposed to have any kind of compromise. This is supposed to be a radical display of the life of Jesus Christ where we no longer live. We are right now in the very midst of this transition, and we are confronting with the power of God all the forces of hell. You won't have your little problems anymore. You won't have your little pet sins anymore. You won't have your little addictions that come from a love of ease and leisure. You step over here in the battle. You start becoming a part of the kingdom of God. All that other stuff. Come on, man. Hallelujah. Yeah, looky here. It's about time God's people start understanding who Christ Jesus is, what the ministry of the kingdom's all about. We have to understand the violence of this transition that we're in the midst of. We have to understand what Jesus went through to bring us salvation. And he said, take up your cross and follow me. What he went through, every day he was delivered to death. Every day he was escaping out of death. Every day he was being given over to persecution, ultimately to be handed over, to be tormented, and ultimately crucified. And he says, come follow me. We are all about confronting the powers of darkness and everything that opposes God and bringing it down to where it no longer exists. God has chosen that through the foolishness of preaching, by the preaching of the word, anybody who would hear could be delivered out of the power of darkness, translated over into the kingdom of the dear Son, become heirs of God and co-inheritors with Jesus Christ, now having been crucified together with him, buried with him by baptism into his death, raised up together with him, alive together, a new creation, a new creature, a new race. A new race of many different languages, of many different skin hues and colors. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. From many different tribes and nations, a new race. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on in. The family is big and the fun lasts forever. Come on in. Hey, we're going to be opposed by devils and evil and wicked men, but that doesn't make any difference. We win. Hallelujah. Come on now. You're going to have to get radical. So now I just pray tonight in Jesus' name. You just want this won't word of God won't fall on deaf ears, and you go back to your love of ease and luxury living, and you know just kind of patty caking religion. Hardly ever say the name of Jesus. It's amazing to me. I can tell a lot about when a person gets up and starts talking about Jesus, how much they know him. Especially if they start trying to do an altar call or start evangelizing or whatever. I can tell how much you know about Jesus. I can tell how deep it goes. Huh? And all that is a reflection of how much time you spend alone with him, how much hunger you have, how much thirsting you have, how deep you've allowed the Holy Ghost to begin to work in life. In other words, how much time you've given yourself to feasting off the Word of God. I'm talking about feasting off the Word of God because you're just reading the Word of God and you ain't growing in that. You got to feast off of it where it fills up all that you have desire of, becomes a definition, the meaning, and the value of your life. Come on now. And I'm here tonight to see if these things that I'm saying, if they're not a reality to you, I'm here tonight to see a change come so that they become a living reality, so that you become an evangel flame, so you become one who's recreated in his image and his likeness, one who's every day being shaped and conformed to the image of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Holy Ghost, because you stepped into a oneness, a living relationship where you dwell in him and his word dwells in you. I'm tired of the nonsense. But false witnesses of the church. It's about time God's people start serving the Lord with all their heart, have a revelation, have their eyes open to see that there is a supernatural provision that is unseen. Hagar, in the desperation of her life, had her eyes open to see a spring that did not exist in a natural world. But she could take her vessel over there and she could fill it and it would bring life. It didn't exist. That spring didn't exist. Her eyes were open so that she could see a spring of water. It didn't exist in the natural world. It existed in the spiritual world. But nonetheless, it was still water supply enough to give them fill. It filled up a volume inside of a vessel. They could drink it. They could taste it. But it came out of another realm. Her eyes were open simply because Ishmael was part of a covenant seed. Even though he was cast out and could not inherit what God had purposed to do through Isaac, he was still the seed of the covenant. He was still the seed of Abraham. And God said, I'll be with him. I'll be with the boy because he's your seed. Come on. And in that desperate situation, because of that provision and that commitment of God, listen, their need demanded that their eyes be open so that they could see that provision that was there all the time. There's a provision right now. The fountain of living water is here right now. You just can't see him. But if you get hungry enough, if you get needy enough, if you get earnest enough, you'll be able to see the fountain of living water standing in your midst. And you'd be shocked. Most of you fall out dead, practically. Huh? Because all of a sudden you have an encounter with God. You go, oh my goodness, it's too much for my heart to handle. He really is real. I mean, we've been singing about him, but my goodness, he really is real. Well, I pray that wouldn't be the case that most of you would fall out dead. I pray that most of you say, I know you're captivated by him. Come fall at his feet. Be overwhelmed with his glory. Not run out the place like, oh, no, we've seen a ghost. Huh? But I know that men that he had appointed to be with him, that was with him for more than 2.5 years, when they saw him in his glory, they all freaked out. Huh? They thought they were going to die. They're hanging on for dear life. Jesus said, be not afraid. Sigh. I'm telling you, people, come on now. Come on now. Jesus doesn't want to be outside of you. He wants to be on the inside of you. He wants to know you to know him intimately. All this doubt and all this fear that's been going on in your life should come to an end because you know that he lives and dwells and walks on the inside of you. Can you imagine that? Moses could not even imagine that. I don't believe that Moses could imagine it. I don't believe that Abraham could imagine it. They saw it afar off. I don't believe that Job could imagine it. And here we are living in it. Ooh, makashi mola mandaya. And the more you give yourself over to heaven, I mean, you're just going to get yourself over in heaven. You're going to have to take inventory of your life and see how much stuff isn't going to heaven with you. How much stuff can you have in your home with him? How much stuff can you bring into the throne room? Huh? How much stuff can you still have around you and do when he comes to your house? People sneaking around on God. Give me a break, man. It's about time you grow up and quit playing games. Being a little child, as it were. God loves you, but he's looking for some people going to be real. I'm going to tell you right now, this is a perilous time. It's a time where God's got to have some people that are willing to be real with him, that are willing to go all the way with him. And so, you know, this is the beauty of what it means to go all the way with him. Are you looking with me in 1 Corinthians chapter 4? 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Hallelujah. I'd rather slur in the anointing than speak with elegance without it. Amen. Hallelujah. Somebody said, what's got a speech impediment? No, man, I tell you right now. I'm standing up here in the glory cloud. Praise God. Woo. And we want to get you over here too, and all you got to do is listen to the word. You know, I look around tonight and I see so many people that aren't here in the meeting. And they talk about one to be in leadership, and they talk about one to grow in the anointing, and they talk about one to grow in the power of God. But yet they always prioritize in God. But if you ask them, you call them on the carpet, no, they had a reason. Always got a good excuse. Always got a good excuse. I'm telling you right now, so long as a good excuse is going to work for you, Satan's going to use it on you every time. Yes. When all of a sudden, when now excuses work anymore, my goodness. Look, I just believe it's a reflection of how many people are going to make heaven. How many going to people? Because we're practicing the assembling ourselves unto him. One day there's going to be in a big assembly. Yes. Huh? Well, these are people going to prioritize something. They're not going to make it. They're going to be busy with whatever it is. I can't even imagine. I'd like to go see what it is. I would like to just all leave here right now and go visit. I could start naming them. I'd like to go visit. We could just all go in the house and say we just wanted to come over and just check out. Yeah! What's more important than Jesus? Oh, but Pastor, that's unfair. They am and they have and they did and they were. Forget about it. It is what it is, man. And they hear the lies and the excuses. I tell you how Jesus said it. Let the dead bury the dead. Follow me.
Yeah.
Amen. People, I'm telling you, everybody's trying to make Jesus nice, you know. And so they got all these various different theories on what he said. What he said was, let the dead bury the dead. And it was in the context of a guy saying, listen, Lord, let me go bury my dad, then I'll come back and follow you. No misinterpretation necessary. The urgency of the kingdom. It's the urgency of the kingdom. It's the urgency of the kingdom. It's the urgency of the kingdom. The urgency. It must be done now. We have no time to wait. We cannot wait for tomorrow. Procrastination is a demonic influence. It belongs to a realm called slothfulness, complacency. It's a synonym with lukewarm. There's no urgency. We're going to have to get alone with God. Bottom line of it is people been sucking on the tit of the world. And I'm telling you right now, they influence with that demonic poison and the head's all messed up and the heart's all messed up so that they cannot have a sense of the urgency. Are you listening to me?
Yes. That is absolutely right.
It's about time we quit being intimate with the world and nursing on the thing. Come on. It's a God's calling for a separation. God, listen, I'm telling you right now, it's all free. It flows from him freely, but it's sacred. Yes. It's still sacred. He's called you. He's separated you, but he's going to examine you because he's not going to allow his sacred to be profaned. His wrath burns against that more than anything. And then when we try to start helping people, help them understand whether the profaning the sacred, whether trampling over the anointing, they all offended. Why? Because they're high on themselves. The pride of life has a stronghold in their life. True. God comes search you out. He will. Just like when Jesus searched out the woman, said, my daughter, she's very grievously vexed and tormented by the devil, by a devil. Come heal her. He said, no, I can't give the children's bread to the dogs. Well, that ain't love. We're out of here. I can't even believe it. They said he was, come on, can't give me a break. She listened to her. She couldn't be offended. She knew who she was talking to. It's a beautiful revelation to recognize that healing is the children's bread, belongs to children. And when you say, give us this day our daily bread, you're getting not only physical provision, spiritual provision, hallelujah, financial provision. You're getting provision in every area of life, all that you have need of. And the woman says, true, Lord, true, true, huh? But the dogs get to eat from the crumbs that fall from the master's table.
Come on, Nephi-Kamotiah. Listen to me. The Phoenicians thought themselves superior to the Israelites. And here an Israelite is calling a Phoenician a dog, and a Phoenician is saying, a Syro-Phoenician woman is saying, true, Lord. All I want is a crumb from your table, Master. Come on, man. He said, look at this great faith right over here. Look at this person not all wrapped up in themselves so big that the flow and the provision of God. Because she would have, her daughter would have continued to be in the same mess that she was in had her attitude been, I can't even believe he said that to me. I'm out of here. It was the same haughtiness of Naaman when the prophet said, go dip 7 times in the Jordan. He said, I'm not going to go to that muddy little creek. We have so much more beautiful rivers and streams in Syria. And then, praise God, he had the counsel of a wise man, a captain that was with him, said, wait, hold up, man. Look, if he'd have asked you to do some great feat, you'd have gone and done it. He just said, go dip. Go humble yourself. Listen, Father is always sorting you out. The situations and circumstances are always trying your heart. They, the floodlight of God, saying, oh, really? You really want me? You really believe in who I am? Huh? Be careful. Next time you're rebuking the devil, it might actually be God sorting you out. Listen, dear people, our actions have big impact on what happens in our future. And it's that way naturally. It's that way spiritually. It's that way in everything. Just imagine how your thoughts, the way you think about people, the way you think about yourself, how it impacts your life. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, your attitude impacts other people's lives, doesn't it? Absolutely. Where'd that come from? I'm going to tell you something that really impacts people's lives, your prayers, how you pray. Whether you believe in them or not, God does. Hallelujah. You're going to get God to shock you if you'll just get intimate with him. You'll go, wow, his ears are really open in my prayer. No kidding. He's living and walking on the inside of you. I mean, come on, you don't have to lift your voice very, very loudly, but, you know, earnestness and passion and intensity. God's laid hold on you so that you lay hold on him. Many people have not responded in that way. And so they've never moved into what God has purposed for them. They just lay down and say, oh, come, something else come trample over me. Something else come kick me. Okay, I'm done with that. Now something else come beat me up. Something else come harass me. Okay, yeah, I'm ready for another disease. Lay it on me. Oh, yeah, go ahead. Bring another problem. No problem. I can take it. There's been no passion to take a hold of those things which God has freely given. The authority to stand up against his powers of darkness that are now trying to oppose the gospel and the anointing as we stand here in this transition from the kingdoms of this world to the kingdom of the dear Son, the kingdoms of God. Behold. The kingdoms of this world become the kingdom of God and of his Christ. Get ready. Hallelujah. It's very soon to be. We headed to a good place. Amen. We were driving down the road the other night. And we were going to a good place. And, just naturally, we're headed to a good place. We're headed home. And I'm driving. I said, and I was just so hit. It's a thunderous thing from the Lord. You know, you walk with him, he's going to come show up and begin to show you things. He's going to open up your eyes that you may behold wondrous things. You don't have to live in all that mess you've been in. Well, you just get into intimacy with God, he'll open your eyes and cause you to behold the glories of the ages. And I'm driving. I said, honey, I said, we going to an amazing place. We headed into an amazing place. She's looking at me like, of course we're going home. What is up? I said, I can see myself 10,000 years from now. I can see myself 150 years from now. Just 60, maybe 70 years from now. We're going to go over into another realm, into the glory where Christ Jesus is, where the Father is, where the heavenly host is, where all eternity exists. It was about time you wake up. Here, come over. Come over here. Wake up. Get over here. Stand in this place. You begin to do what God's called you to do, you're going to get yourself in trouble. You begin to do what God's called you to do, and people are going to hate you. Oh, I just want friends. I just got to have more friends. I'll tell you right now, you start doing what God wants you to do, and everybody's going to hate you. And your dear friends that you need so desperately are going to run away and forsake you. Because you've been following Jesus. And that's what happened to him. And anybody who follows him, that's what's going to happen to them. Well, I'm just not ready for that. I need more friends. I need camaraderie. I need security that comes from, you know, having a bunch of people that like me. You need Jesus. And then you won't need all that anymore. You need to be filled up with life divine, and that become nothing. Pleasing him will be more important to you than pleasing anyone else. Now, I want you to look at this verse of scripture with me here in 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, forgive me, chapter 4, verse 10. Paul said, I'm always bearing in my body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. I always carry about or bear in my body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in my body. Boy, does that ever sound like a paradox? He's bearing in his body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, that simultaneously, because he bears in his body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, the very life of Jesus Christ is manifested in his body. Now, he's going to take it, and he's going to explain it a little bit more, but take it to another notch. Watch him take it. Now he's going to raise his voice a little bit. Okay? And he's going to say it. Now listen to how he says it is. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake. Hello. No. I understand. That's what everybody's response is. No. New car. New house. Pretties. Comfortable. Compounder. Powder puff my pew, my bottom sore, whatever. We always delivered over unto death. We are killed all the day long and counted our sheep for the slaughter. Yeah, because that's the opposing force. That's why people hate me, because of the anointing. They're going to hate you when you got yourself an anointing. They hate me because his word is in my mouth. They're going to hate you when his word's in your mouth. And then all of a sudden, you've been talking bad about the anointed one, the person who had the word of God in their mouth, and now it's all turn around and double on you because you just stepped into a move of God. Hello? Hello? Yeah, now you're in the spotlight. Hallelujah. Now you're center stage. Now you're at the place of fame in the kingdom of God. Now you're at the place of living out the heroic life in Jesus. Hello. Always, amen, always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. Woo. We went from body to mortal flesh. This two verse scripture really helps you to understand that the soma, or the body, can also be understood as the sarx, the mortal flesh, which many people want to make every time they see sarx, oh, it's got to be something evil, and they just steal all kinds of wild theology because they never got to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. They didn't want to get there. And they won't even contemplate that this is a reality, that what Paul is saying is, I got myself in the middle of everybody who don't want to hear about Jesus, the unreached people groups where you'll surely die if you go preach there, the people that are going to beat you up for the testimony of Jesus Christ, and I open my mouth wide open, and I let everybody know that we've just moved into town. That God has just invaded the planet Earth, and I'm here to tell you, get yourself packed up and get ready to go. One way or the other, because you've got a destination. Either pack up and get ready to move into heaven, or pack up and get ready to go, because everything's leaving out of this realm that doesn't belong to God. I want you to hear it tonight, because you need to go. Some of you need to go home and clean house. Some of you need to clean up the shop of your thought life. Some of you need to clean up the shop of your heart. Some of you need to clean up the shop of your attitude and your affections. And you're all stale and moldy and crusty because you sit around in a damn closet of a room and live out your life there for Jesus. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
It's time to get out in the sunshine. Breathe the free air. Come on, live. Walk upon the high places, upon the mountaintops. It's time to live big for the kingdom of God. It's time to be willing to go all the way. To where that every day you're being handed over. Paul constantly lived every day on the edge of being killed. He knew right, left, and center. Yeah, that's some homework. I can help you with that. I did it. Praise God. We went through that and we're successful. Mom says, I'll just leave it alone. I said, well, I have a real hard time of being a neutral bystander when I know all I got to do is this and it'll be fixed. I have a real hard time being a neutral bystander in your life going, look at a man just destroying himself. Look at her just beating herself up. Why don't you go get destroyed for Jesus and beat up for Jesus instead of destroyed and beat up for all that other nonsense? Yeah. Why don't you go get knocked around in the kingdom of God instead of getting knocked around in the kingdom of darkness? Huh? Why don't you go live in the riches of heaven? Hallelujah. Yeah. Instead of the oppression of this world. Why don't you get all that stuff that causes sorrow and sadness? You know what's causing sorrow and sadness? The absence of the peace of God because you're not obeying God. That's why people are upset and depressed and unhappy. They lack the peace because God the Holy Ghost is dealing with the heart saying you're not doing what's right. And all they want to do is, you know, go and eat it away or shop it away or go watch another movie. Cram them spiritual, cram all this stuff into their spiritual being and hoping that somehow it might mitigate this sense of undoneness. Hello. Glad you came tonight.
Yeah.
So are you, whether you realize it or not, you're glad you came tonight. I'm on it. And I'm just going to, you know, before I talk a little bit more about living as a minister in the midst of great conflict in the midst of a hostile community where everybody around you is demanding you keep your mouth shut, you open your mouth, and I'm going to bust your mouth. And they did that literally to Paul. Listen, I'm telling you right now, there was times where he was stoned and dead. He was left for dead, yeah? And I can tell you right now, those guys were expert at stoning. If they stoned you and they said you were dead, you dead. I mean, after being pulverized so many times in the head with rocks, you know, and big ones, the rock I threw myself was big enough to take them out. And I smacked them right upside the head. And the scripture says he got up. You could just see Paul digging himself out from underneath the pile of rocks. Kind of lifts his head up. Yeah, they're all gone, okay? Pushes all the rocks off and went on to the next town. Hallelujah. Praise God. This is who he lived. Thrice I was, I'm not going to get into that yet. I'm going to show you what it means that he was constantly being delivered over to death. Jesus was constantly being delivered over to death. He was constantly having to escape out of their hands. They were constantly trying to kill him. From the very beginning of his ministry, his own hometown, they tried to throw him off the cliff. Glad you made it. Who knows, maybe some other people who are wayward will start coming in as well. After the meeting's about half over. You listen, people, God, Father wants to get your attention. You can't move on with God until he gets your attention. You always making your own priority. You always deciding what it is you're going to do. Huh? Miles away. Huh? Become close. Change your name. Get near. Huh? Stop planning out your own life. Let God plan your life for you. He already told you what to do. You don't even have to make any decisions. Isn't that cool? I don't have to make any decisions. Mine are made for me by principle. God's already told me exactly what to do. The order of my life is already set. Amen. Hallelujah. That's how I know that when the trumpet of the Lord sounds, I know where I'm going to be. Or I know that when I put off this body, I know exactly what's going to happen. I will not see death. I'll make a transition right over into glory. I'll go from this life in him to that life in him. Hallelujah. I want the same for you. But until you're willing to come and sit and be taught of God and come under divine authority and begin to make the principles of the kingdom of God that which is the demands over your life, nothing's going to change in your life. People are making decisions all the time that impact whether or not God's going to use them. God laid hold on you so you can lay hold on him, but a lot of folks aren't doing that. They're still laying hold on themselves. God laid hold on him and you hugging yourself too. Well, yeah, it is good. I feel so wonderful about myself. The Lord wants you to become so captivated by him that you're so in love with him that this exchange of life, you no longer live. You don't exist. Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. I'm dead with him. I'm buried with him. I carry about always in my body a death sentence. I'm already dead, he's saying. I'm like, how can you kill a dead guy? I'm already dead.
I'm already dead. And the reason that the life of Jesus may be seen in my body and that the life of Jesus may be manifested in my mortal flesh is because I'm already dead. It is a proof of the way that I behave myself, the way that I conduct my life, the way that I give myself completely over to the purposes of heaven. It proves by the way that I move and by the way that I preach and by the way that I have completely surrendered everything about my purpose in life, that I belong to Him. And because of that, His life is fully revealed in me. That's all that's seen here. Because I'm not living my own life. I'm not doing my own thing. I'm running wide open for the King of Kings. The Lord is not going to be impressed that you got a promotion. He's not going to be impressed with your degrees. He's not going to be impressed that people like you. He's not. He's going to only be impressed with whether or not you obeyed Him and did the Father's will. That's it. He's not going to be impressed with your house of sticks and your foundation of hay. And your roof of stubble. It's gone with this nice little match. This nice little bit of fire. People, we're going to have to get into a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ to a place and to a point that when circumstances and situations that have even nothing to do with us preaching the gospel come along, our house doesn't collapse. The house that we're supposed to have that stands as a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And people have winds and waves and storms coming at them and their house collapses. It has nothing to do with the kingdom of God. It's your own stuff. It's because you didn't get your way. Because it didn't work out for you. You don't have as much money as the other guy. No, people don't love you as much as it seems like they love everybody else. And all the other stuff we whine and cry and fuss over has nothing even to do with the kingdom of God. Right. I'm suffering for the Lord. Really? What happened?
Well, sister so-and-so, she was talking to the other sister so-and-so bad about me. I'm just bearing my cross. I got to do it.
Nothing to do with suffering for Jesus. Nothing to do with bearing the cross. Everything to do with you and the preservation of your own life. No bearing the death of the Lord Jesus in your body. No delivered over to death. When we go to Nepal, we were delivered over to death. When we go to Kashmir Valley, delivered over to death. Huh? When we stand up tomorrow in our situations of our life and we don't let up, we say, listen, I'm going to tell you right now, Christ Jesus is coming. Are you ready to meet Him? I'm telling you, you're standing right in a transition, and if you continue in the way that you're going, you're going to be spending eternity in hell. Just try that. Just try that with your close friends. Try that with people around you. Some are going to respond, especially if it comes out of the realms of the anointing and the power of the Holy Ghost, and it's going to be beautiful. Others, you're never going to see them again. And you talk about getting talked bad about. What did they talk bad about you? They talked bad because the color of your shoes didn't match your blouse? And you're all upset? Just think of what it's going to be when they're talking bad about you for the gospel's sake. Are you listening to me? People, it's just like the Lord says, just not even mess with them. Leave them alone, man. They're still worried about the colors of their shoes matching their blouses. We'll come back to them later. Let's go find some people that are ready to go. Mark, you take care of them for a while. No, I'm just kidding. I'm good. It's true. It really is true. Praise God for His mercy and His long suffering and His gentleness. That He continues to work with us and plead with us and say, hey, 40 years later, do you get it yet? I am the Lord. You got it yet? Me. I am the Lord. You are my servant. All that I have is yours. Got it yet? No? Okay. I am the Lord. 45 years later. 50. He's long-suffering. He's gentle. He's patient. But I'm telling you right now, people, if we just respond and lay hold on Him and begin to take Him seriously at His word and begin to step out and obey Him, and it's going to cost you. You say, I'm a little fearful. That's right. Get yourself up and face that fear and knock it right upside the head. You in the transition. You're not called to, you know, be in some kind of, you know, entertainment center. Will you sing a song when we were little? Yeah. It's a battlefield, rather not a recreation hall. People think they ain't recreation. I don't want to go out there. It's scary.
there's a fight going on. There's a battle going on. I might get hurt. My hair might get messed up. Don't sit there and look at me too smug, because I'm going to get you a one-way ticket to a place where you're going to get in trouble. And we'll test out whether or not you, how sincere you are with the Lord. We'll invite you to forsake everything. Come follow Jesus. Because the reality of it, I'm going to tell you right now, people, many of you in this place here tonight are not there yet. You're not there yet. You say you're there, but let me give you the ticket. We'll pack up your bags and say, and we'll see you off at the airport. And we'll be praying for you every day. Send money when we can. I mean, just think about it. How many of you really, you're just there. It's been tested in your life. You're there. You're ready to go. You're ready to leave everything behind. Amen. If you start taking inventory, you start getting serious with God, you start searching your heart. Some of you won't even turn off your TV. Just try it. Watch out. I'm going to help you. It's become a comfort to you. I'm going to help you. There's certain little, your puppy dog, what am I going to do with a puppy? If I go obey Jesus, what's going to happen with a puppy? Who even cares? Who even cares? I mean, you got to figure out what you're going to do with puppy before you're going to obey Jesus. Yeah, I'm talking to you. Yeah, we're running this down by the power of the Holy Ghost. Yeah, Father's looking for some people that with total abandonment would begin to serve Him as empty vessels poured out before Him, who will bear in their body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, who count themselves to be killed all day long and as sheep for the slaughter. Yes, He's looking for people like that. I'm going to give you another verse of Scripture real quickly before I go into too much more of this. I said that already, didn't I? 2 Corinthians, I'm just having to retract it. Go back, rather. Repeat. Verse 5, chapter 1, verse 5. There's so much to say on this. I wish you'd think about yourself different. Hallelujah. You know, I wish you'd begin to think about the fact that you in Him and He's in you, that you called as a heavenly ambassador to go in with great power and authority to make conquest in Jesus' name, to cast out devils, that you've got a treasure on the earthen vessel. Now we'll go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Everybody's going to get all excited about we have this treasure. That's verse 7 of chapter 4. That's going to lead you right into verse 10 and 11. Now when we get to 10 and 11, everybody's gulping. What is he saying now? He sounds like this is works. Yeah, that's the words and phrases people use to try to get out of obeying God. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah. One person heard me over here, praise God. Maybe a couple of others are still barely chuckling about it. Amen? Hallelujah. For 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 5 says, "For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also aboundeth by Christ." Look, the sufferings of Christ. Tell me about His sufferings. Tell me about His rejection. Tell me about how he was smitten, accused Him and thought of Him as one who was smitten, afflicted by God, one who was an outcast, rejected, possessed by the devil. Everybody going about trying to kill Him, destroy Him, till ultimately one day He was handed over, and that was fully accomplished. Look at this. Look here. Verse 5. Look, this is our testimony. This is yours and my testimony. "For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so also." And there this word is the more than enough. I don't hear anybody shouting about more than enough right now. This is the more than enough word. Oh, He's more than enough. Amen. The sufferings of Christ abound in us. It's more than enough. Amen. We can understand it. Listen, come on, people. I'm trying to help you just a little bit. Understand, if you want to get in a place where God's glory may be manifested through your life in a greater way, you're going to have to get yourself into trouble. And it's easy to get yourself into trouble. Just start being the ambassador of Christ and begin to live out your life fully for the kingdom of God. Forsake everything. Come follow Him. I'm working desperately to divest myself of all earthly goods and still be responsible for the things that the Lord has given me to do that I believe is something that Father has a strategy from heaven that's going to last until Jesus comes. But I wouldn't be able to say, "Silver and gold have I none." I'm ready. I'm just telling you right now, dear people, you must understand me. I am ready. I could go right now and live my life in Saudi Arabia. I could go right now, live my life in Tajikistan. I can go right now, live my life in Kashmir. You name it, hot spot, North Korea. I'm gone. Now, Father, here, use me. Take hold of me, oh God, and use me.
Amen.
Fact is, you know, the Lord has taken hold of me, so that I take hold of him, and I say, Lord, I take hold of you, now you use me. Well, you know how you're going to have to grow and mature a little bit before that even makes any sense to you. Are you hearing me? Father wants to have that kind of relationship. He wants to build up on the inside of you such a desperation for his will to be done in your life that you begin to demand him. And that's why the Lord says in that relationship, command ye me. Hallelujah. God says, let go of me. And as Jacob says, no. That's direct disobedience. But it's a good disobedience. Hallelujah. That's a direct disobedience. Let go of me. No. I'm not letting go of you till you put your blessing on me. I'm not letting go of you till you use me. I'm not letting go of you till you do more in my life. I'm not letting go till you fulfill everything you said about your people in my life. Hear me. I'm glad to hear you clapping. I'm telling you right now. I'm telling every one of you is clapping. You've got it. Listen, one of those of you who aren't clapping yet, I'm praying that you're going to get it. You can say you got it, but you don't got it enough to get excited about it, huh? I guarantee you, if the whatever it is, clearinghouse comes and puts $1 billion on the front doorstep, you're gonna be doing more than cracking a smile. Are you listening to me? And they start talking to you about how all your provisions are taken care of for the rest of your life. They're gonna deal it out, you know, and deal it out to you in $1 million a week or whatever, huh? I guarantee you, a little bit more than. Father has given us far more. Woo! He's given us far more than that. He said, come stand with me. He said, but I will suffer though. Jesus paid the whole price that I don't have to suffer. You off the hook. Just go back over there. Just go back over there with the women folk. And the children. Just go sit yourself down. We don't want to stretch you. Listen to me. My wife says, you know, she said, I might be the woman folk, but I'm going to be standing right there.
Amen.
I'm going to be right in the middle of it. I'm going to be pushing the thing. I'm going to be pushing it down. I'm going to be telling Satan and everything else that is going on in the realms of darkness, what's going on, how it's coming down, and how they got to leave right now. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm going to be going after every soul that I can. And you're going to have to deal with the forces and the power of religion, just like Paul dealt with the forces and the power of religion. The forces and the power of the Jewish religion, the forces and the power of the religions of false gods like Diana and others, the Queen of Heaven. He said, I wrestled with beasts at Ephesus. Man, he took it on. He brought it down. He said, listen, I'll tell you right now. Let me show you how this works. I'm going to show you how the strength, you can have the strength and the power of Almighty God. You can have the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Let me show you what it looks like because I fought with beasts at Ephesus. I was delivered out of the lion's mouth. Come on, listen to me. Come on now. You want to, listen, Papa wants to bring you into relationship so much, a relationship of intimacy with him, that you're willing to go all the way with him. Not part of the way, you're willing to go all the way with him. Your whole life is about him. You're so excited about the fact that you have this kind of authority, that you have this kind of privilege, that you have this kind of call upon your life. You're not going to sit back and be discouraged because doors didn't open for you. You go in and lay hold of God and say, Father, you need me. Use me. I'm ready. Not to go take up an offering. Not to get some fame. But to go all the way with you. It's about time that God's people in America be raised up now to invade the foreign field. Where 3 billion people that have never heard can begin to hear. It's about time. It's about time. The people begin to say goodbye to all the stuff that has overwhelmed their life and say, we killed all the day long. You go over there, you're going to be killed. No problem, man. I'm killed all the day long and counted as already a sheep for the slaughter. No problem. Oh, you're going to You're going to suffer. You're going to get thrown in jail. No problem. I bear in my body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, that the life of Jesus might be made manifest in me. For we have been delivered over unto death. We've already been delivered over to death. Men are already going to kill us just like he killed them. We on Satan, I don't know. Somebody said, oh, I might be on ISIS hit list. You on Satan's hit list, man.
Yes. Yes to that.
You on Satan's hit list. Do you understand that? Yes. You better get yourself some movement. I'm going to give myself a gun. What is that going to do? Man, you're going to fire the thing and miss. I guarantee you, if a deer jumped out in front of you, you would miss because you'd get all excited. You're listening to me. It's crazy. People think crazy. Oh, well, I've been target practicing. It's very different to aim at a person or even a little bunny. Have you killed a bunny? No? I guarantee you, you're going to miss. And the other person with the gun is going to hit you. He's not going to miss. It's true. Guns attract guns. People putting their, it's Christians going all over the place. I hear people, Christians, all going getting a gun. Gun telling Christian all day right now. Well, that's not what we're called to do. What Bible are you reading? What on earth? What in heaven is going on around here? Preachers. I had a preacher the other day bragging to me that he's got a license to tote a gun in 48 of the states. He's got a license. I'm like, what big deal, man? You don't even know how to use it. You don't even know how to use it. You got freaked out when I killed a rattlesnake with my heel. No, it's true. You don't even know how to use that gun. That gun attracts guns. You got the power and the authority of the Word of God in your mouth.
Yeah.
What are you talking about? I mean, listen, I'm telling you, people are standing around Paul with swords and spears and every weapon, and no weapon formed against him could prosper. Yeah. You tread upon scorpions and serpents and all the power of the enemy. Yeah. Evil has been done over and over again. You don't die until God says so. Yeah. They throw you in oil and boil you in oil. You don't boil.
That's right.
It ain't your time. They put you on an island where there's no food or water. You fine. You come out shining like the sun. You don't even look like you missed a meal. They deliver you out of Patmos, and now you come back and write the whole of the New Testament. Basically, seal it up at any rate. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Come on, people. It is crazy. You guys could quit watching CNN. You need to quit watching the Fox News. It's just nothing but a drama. And any of it true? None of it's true. It's like maybe one tenth of a percent truth, or 1/10 of a percent, forgive me, fact mixed with 99.99% big gigantic lie. And you're like, it's amazing, all the stuff that's coming on Facebook. Everybody's in a panic. Everybody's in fear. Hello! You're delivered over unto death. Hello! Don't you realize you're standing here in the place of a transition, the phasing out of all of these things that belong to the power of darkness, and Father has clothed you with his power and his authority and his majesty, and you cannot die until he says so. Bullets will fall at your feet.
Amen. It's true.
Somebody who's an expert with a sword will try to stab you and miss you every time. What's wrong with my sword? There's something I can't see that's blocking it. It keeps... I was standing in a meeting one night in a foreign field, and I said to my wife, I said, that person up there has got a gun in that bag. Some malice. He's come here to wreak havoc. And I felt very strongly that it was focused on me. You know what the first thing I did when that was made real to me? I just turned around and I said, thank you, Father, for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Jesus, you're so amazing, so wonderful. It's just such a blessing to be here. It wasn't long that guy was in the altar. His bag was gone. Hallelujah. Kataba. Holy Ghost conviction has a great power. It grips the hearts of men. Huh? You come under the fear, you're taken out. Huh? You stand in the glory, in the presence of the Lord, they'll come under the fear and they'll be taken out. Amen. They're going to be gripped with fear. I'm not going to be gripped with fear. Come on, dear people. Hallelujah. God's given us authority over all the powers of darkness. There's not an enemy on the planet that can match the anger, the ferociousness, the ferociousness. I get it out here, man. The forcefulness and the ferociousness and the murderous intent and the hate that Satan has towards you. And you all worried about a man? You don't even believe and understand the reality of the satanic power set against you. Once you've understood and come to recognize the protection you have in Christ Jesus against all the forces of hell, men become nothing, a small thing. Fear is not able to take you, not able to hold you. I want to go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And you know, it's so important when you see 2 Corinthians chapter 4, as things begin to be set up for you, we see that Paul's really, his focus is on the lost, and the God of this world has blinded their eyes. But he's coming with the authority to open up their eyes. Somebody was saying to another person, all this preaching about the believer and the authority of the believer, it's all nonsense. It's all nonsense. God gave Paul the power and the authority to turn people from Satan to God. Where's yours at? Because he's not just some kind of outlier, some kind of a unique person who has a relationship with the Lord that nobody else can have. He is an example and a model who said, come follow me. This is the way to live. I'm following Jesus. Come follow me. God has given us an authority. We don't recognize it because we live under the yoke too much, the oppression too much, the concerns of this life too much, the influences that demonic powers are throwing at us, and don't even recognize that that emotion is a demonic influence to try to subjugate you to its power. And people, you're going to have to mature and grow up. Otherwise, you're not going to like me very long. You're going to get sick and tired of listening to me yelling about here. Huh? Ranting and raving going on. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Might as well fall into line. Get into the ranks. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. God's got an army. Huh? Not a social club. God's got an army. Huh? Come on.
Hallelujah.
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 He places us all, brings us all into view with the heavenly vision. Because Paul said it's a heavenly vision. He told King Agrippa concerning the heavenly vision. The heavenly vision then was passed on to every one of us. A mandate that we have a heavenly vision. And the heavenly vision being the ability to turn people from the power of Satan unto God, to turn them from death, darkness, unto life, light, to open up the eyes of the blind. This is who we are. Listen, the Lord went everywhere and said, repent. He didn't make altar calls like, would you like to accept me? He went, repent. He commanded everybody to repent. We go and do all these kind of whatever it is we're doing. This has been inspired by the merchandising, the socializing, the commercializing. Huh? And a few other isings that I don't want to mention. The Lord wants us to have authority. The Lord wants us to look into people's life with the blessing and the mercy and the grace of God and say, listen, you need to change. Repentance needs to come into your life. Things that's been going on in your life needs to come to an end. God's calling you. You have to understand, you're headed to a place that you don't want to go. I mean, someone's going to have to step up and start believing what God says and be an ambassador, one who speaks in Christ's stead. Somebody's going to have to start. It's going to have to become so real in our life by the authority of the Holy Ghost that we begin to be the people who say, look, if the house is burning down, you ought to get out.
Amen.
I'm a dreamer. I have dreams. God constantly visits me in dreams. Sometimes I wake up going, Lord, what on earth did that mean? But many, many times it's not that way at all. I've been in places where I was standing outside screaming at people, saying that your house is burning down. They're looking at me out the window like, I can't believe you hollering at me. No. No, I'm not kidding you. I can't believe you're talking to me like that. I'm going, your house, the house is burning down. It's coming down around you. And then be so earnest, go inside the house and say, listen, come out now. And they're standing there looking at me with a defiant look. Who do you think you are? And then I wake up, go, my goodness gracious, that's what's going on in the meeting. No, I'm telling you right now, identifiable faces who weren't here anymore. And I begged them and I pled with them and they didn't understand. So much of the meeting was just so devoted to their rebellion and their stubbornness, and they're wanting to sit there in their own mind with their own thoughts and resist everything that's coming out of my mouth, as though I'm just a man espousing my own opinion. I'm not just a man espousing my own opinion. I'm a pastor in a place that God has given me an anointing to function in, just like he gave a prophet the ability to function in. Just like he gave a king ability to function in. Just like he gave a priest an ability to function in. I'm a pastor set in a place by God, given an ability to function in this office to declare these things of God's word that you can go home and read over and over again. And that by and large, most of this, the things that I say, you can, there's hundreds of witnesses out there if you get people who are more scholarly of the word, more have more understanding of the word of God. I don't care what denomination they come from. I was preaching in Alexandria, Egypt, and the Jesuits. I mean, I had the leaders of the church, Coptics there, Jesuits there, Methodists there, Presbyterian there. Presbyterians, the academicians really of the Christian community. But the Jesuits, they're the academicians of the Roman Catholic Church. I got finished with the ministry that day, and it was the Jesuits that came and said, just Tommy, we're so glad that Mark's returned to Egypt. We're so glad to hear the word of God being preached. Because I don't care what flavor you are, the word of God is the word of God.
Amen.
And the bottom line of it is there's a whole lot more Reader's Digest being espoused than there is the word of God. So much more of the opinion, Facebook propaganda and conspiracy theories.
Right.
Jesus help us. Oh Lord, I'm not going to even get into that. I mean, I just got flooded with a whole bunch of thoughts. But I mean, I know my thoughts different from his. The ideas are the things that you and I are faced with on a daily basis, and we don't even have the insight or the wisdom to be able to sort through it. And the wisest men in the realms of fleshly wisdom don't have the ability to sort through it either. We have to depend upon the Holy Ghost, who's come to lead us and to guide us in the truth and give us wisdom and insight to where we say, that's a bunch of nonsense. That isn't even true. I'm not even going there. Your propaganda ain't going to work on me. U.S. American propaganda can't work on me. Israeli propaganda can't work on me. Russian propaganda can't work on me. It doesn't. Iranian propaganda can't work on me. I'm over here. God placed us in charge of the nations. He gave us the ability to go make disciples out of them, and we're going to have to get out of our little prison of fear, depending on our little pistol that we can't even shoot. What was that guy's name? The shakiest gun in the West.
Don
Knotts. There we are. A bunch of Don Knotts running around. Give me a break. Where is sanity? Are you hearing me? Where is sanity? When we've been given all this authority, we've been given all this protection. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We've been given all this provision, and we go to the arm of flesh and we trust in ourselves. Well, it's just going to be a natural consequence when you've given me a whole line to trusting in the arm of flesh for your own provision. Then you're going to trust in the arm of flesh for your own protection. Jesus. People, things are going to get bad, but don't worry. We're good.
Amen.
We're good. I was telling a dear friend of mine the other day, the Lord's really blessed him in wealth, but he's like, I don't even want all this. I want to run. He's getting ready to do it. He's setting up to do a crusade in Cuba, which, we're going to be a part of it with him. And I said, I just want to go. I said, every place you took me, I took him to Papua New Guinea, I took him to Nepal with me. He said, every place that you took me, it's so big in my heart, I want to be back there. I don't even want to be doing this, but the Lord won't release me. That's fine. And he's got a tent set up there in his backyard doing tent meetings. And he still wants to be out there. God's got him under restraint right now. And it's obvious why. Because he's making millions and millions of dollars for the kingdom, and all he wants to do is run with it. He just wants to run with it. Because the Lord says, no. He didn't have anybody. Bottom line is, Father don't have any, too many people making all that kind of money. Most people just, they're just so stoked that they're buying Christmas presents this year. You know what I'm saying? It's like me, oh Lord bless me and mine and my four, no more. I mean, it's just crazy stuff. Our attitudes, our disposition. God wants us to have a much bigger vision of things. He wants us to step out and lay hold of those things that are there and within the framework of what he's called us and purposed us to do. The Lord didn't get the brightest and the best. He didn't get the brightest and the best. But praise God for the Holy Ghost. Amen. Comes, changes us. Hallelujah. And it fills us with heaven. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. He got the Peter. Amen. And the John. You know, about all they know how to do is fish. But he fills them with the wisdom of heaven so that everybody recognizes these men have been with Jesus. He fills them with the authority of heaven that the greatest minds and the greatest talents can't even stand in their presence. Amazing. Come on now. Amazing. Let's step into all that Papa has made available for us. Quit looking for the world, a handout from the world. Quit digging for gold in the midst of humanity. Step over here in this realm. Come, give yourself completely over to obeying God. Get radical with the territory of your life. The territory of your own person. And all the things that have come to try to invade your life. Stand out and run them off. Huh? Clear the land of the giants that somehow cohabitated in your head. You know what I'm saying? Yep. Set up there. Are you listening to me? Set up there fortified cities in your life. Intimidating you, causing fear, running all kinds of interference in your life, giving you affections that you're not supposed to have that are purely and entirely earthly. Where you're living out your own life, it's time for you and I, it's time for us, it's time for you to hear that you take a hold of and you recognize that what we're talking about here tonight isn't some, you know, variant, unique expression in Christianity, but it is the model that you and I take a hold of and say, I bear in my body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm given over always to death. I live on the edge of being taken and having my head chopped off. I live always at that moment of with complete consecration to the Lord that my life should come to an end for his namesake so that his life may be fully revealed in me. Because as long as we're hanging on to our own life, he can't be fully revealed in our life. Because really what Paul is saying is just a more radical declaration of what Jesus said. Take up your cross, deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. Just a more radical declaration. It's just bringing it right down to how, listen to how he says it in these verses. Listen to me, okay? Of course, you really got it. You got to take up verse 7. You know, verse 6 and verse 7, for God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness to shine into our hearts, the revelation of heaven, in the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ, he's given us an unveiled revelation of his person and the effulgency of the beauty of his own light that no man could approach unto, nor no man has seen. And now we get to stand here face to face and behold his glory. And he says, and we have these treasures in earthen vessel. This treasure in an earthen vessel, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. That's the same thing as when we talk about Christ in us, the power of the Holy Ghost on the inside of us. Now unto him who is able to do superabundantly more than we can think or ask, according to his power that is at work on the inside of us. There's a glory realm of heaven. All that he himself has, he's deposited into our life because he himself has come into our life. Somebody said, are you trying to be equal God? No. God's come into my life. Hello. God in my life. I'm sorry that you don't believe that, but God, I believe that Christ has come into me. Hallelujah. Holy Ghost is in me, and he is God, and he's doing the work. I don't have to try to be nothing. I'm dead. Hallelujah. The one you all concerned about trying to be equal with God and all upset about, we're talking about authority and power. That one's dead. Crucified with Christ, buried with him by baptism into death. raised up together with him, now living and walking in the realms of divine glory, bearing in my body his death, that his life may be also revealed in me. Because I've been delivered over to death for his name's sake, so that his life might be made manifest in my mortal flesh. So that Jesus may be made manifest, his life manifest in my mortal flesh. I love that. I love that because people got all these things to say about mortal flesh. Hallelujah. And now Jesus can be standing right in the midst of it and be revealed in it. It's beautiful, isn't it? Paul says here, just listen to me now, because I want to get you in the meeting. I want to get you into the ministry. I want to get you into your assignment in God. I want you to quit diddle-dallying around, tell me you're doing something in the kingdom and it's nonsense because you're not risking nothing. You listen to me? All you're doing is trying to influence people and win friends. I'm going to tell you right now, as soon as you start walking with him, you will suffer persecution. Huh? There was a time early in my life I came to a minister. I said, I'm concerned about myself. He says, what's wrong? I said, I got too many friends. I said, I really don't get any persecution. And the minister just smiled. He just chuckled a little bit. He said, hang on. Suddenly, as I stepped into a greater discipline in the things of the Spirit and obedience to the Word of God, I understood. If they call me, Jesus said, if they call me Beelzebub, if they say that I'm possessed of devils, what are they going to say about you? The way they treated me, they're going to treat you too. Well, come on, people. What's wrong with it? Look, no surprise. Huh? Quit being all fearful whether or not they're going to accept you or reject you. More than likely, they're going to reject you. No problem. You killed all day long and counted as a sheep for the slaughter. Quit hanging onto your own life. Get over here in the big middle of the ministry. Get over here in the big middle of the controversy. Get over here in the big middle of the battle. Get over here in the big middle of the transition that is going on. Listen to this. Paul says this, verse 8. He says, we are troubled on every side. And this isn't about, well, I got a bill here and a bill there and a bill over here. This isn't build, build, build. Huh? We're troubled on every side. This isn't about self-interest and earthly stuff. I'm concerned about the mortgage. I'm thinking about a new car. You know, I'm just concerned about the transmission. Kind of like, it's sounding a little weird. I don't know anything about mechanics, but I figure I need a new car. Are you hearing me? I'm talking about most people's troubles. Right even in this place here tonight. He's talking about a different kind of trouble. He's talking about the trouble on every side because he's breaking open nations. He's talking about the trouble on every side because he's advancing the kingdom of God. By the time, it isn't too long after Paul's dead and the Roman Empire ceases to exist. It isn't too long and Paul is dead and the great supposed goddess Diana, who had been for 2,000 years almost a sovereign god in all that region, is no longer worshipped. One guy, one little short guy, who's got the fire of God in his eyes, who says, the death I bear in my body, the death I always carry around, the death of Jesus Christ, that the life of Jesus Christ may be revealed to me. I'm going exactly where he's going. I've set myself to be handed over to the tormentors. I've set myself to be rejected, to despise, to be crucified. I've set myself over to my body. I count it really, he's literally saying, because he uses a unique Greek word. Necrosis. He uses the word necrosis. He usually uses another word for death. He uses literally a word that means, I count my body like a corpse. It's only for the purpose of Jesus being glorified in it. Ooh. Ah, I got just to enter into most of your problems. Everybody, I just canceled out most of your problems. You don't have any more problems. Anybody in here don't have more problems anymore. Issues are all gone. All those troubles you came in with, they cease to exist. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You got a whole new assignment in life. Instead of the cares of this world, the cares of yourself, now you all belong to the kingdom of God. And your body's just walking around here to be ambassadors of the transition that's taking place in the kingdom of God that is about ready to be revealed. And a call to all mankind to come on over, call upon the name of the Lord Jesus, they be saved.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Come on, people. Come on now. Come on now. God has more anointing than what's ever been revealed in your life. He wants the anointing to be so expressed to your life that you say Jesus and people shake under the power of His presence. You begin to talk about who He is and what He's done, and people come under great Holy Ghost conviction.
Yes.
Come on now.
Yes.
You have to get out of yourself, get into Him.
Amen.
You have to quit making your own life and writing your own calendar.
Amen.
Paul says, we're troubled on every side. This is what the gospel gets you into, being minister of the gospel. We're troubled on every side, but we're not distressed. Do we look upset? We're troubled on every side, but we don't care. He says, we're perplexed, but we're not in despair. He said, we're persecuted, but we're not forsaken. He said, we're cast down, but we're not destroyed. I want you to look over with me here in the next chapter, chapter 5. Many things to say, just kind of want to just highlight verse 15. Huh? And verse 14, 15, of course, you hear me say it all the time. I quote the scripture a lot. But I want you to live it all the time. We're quoting this so that you can live it, that you can believe it about yourself. When you're all upset about that your cake didn't come to you delivered properly with the right kind of color on it, and you now all completely out of sorts and about on the phone screaming and hollering at somebody over there because they didn't put the right color on there and forgot all about their eternal soul and all about the purpose for which you live. Come on. I want you to remember this verse of scripture. Huh? When you're hollering at the person over there at In-N-Out Burger because they didn't get it right. Or wherever it is that you go. And wherever it is you throw your fits and temper tantrums over your little old self-interest. Are you listening to me? Huh? Come on now. Come on now. We got to quit living for ourselves, start living for the kingdom. We got a big calling here. Yeah. We've been given an opportunity to live big in God. I mean, God's moved in. Come on, man. Let Him live. Come on. God's moved in. Let Him be in charge. Come on. Christ Jesus is here. Let Him open your eyes so you can see Him. Yeah. Hey, you're the seed of the covenant. God's got unimaginable, unspeakable gifts for you.
Yes.
People are worried about what they can get out of this world, want to get out of. Come on. How about all the things the Father's freely given us in the realms of heaven? How about a citizenship that's far greater than any other citizenship? Evil men have stepped in and tried to claim the United States of America for their own self as though by their own power and their own ability they'd gotten it. No, the United States of America was birthed because of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. History has written it. It's signed, sealed, and delivered. I have ancestors from the 1630s whose blood is in it. It wasn't about taking up arms. It wasn't about all this other stuff. It was about the purposes of the kingdom of God. Huh? About time this nation become a disciple again. Just watch, see what's going to happen. It isn't done by legislation, by force. It's not done by some kind of, judicial rule. It is done by the great outpourings of the Holy Ghost. People bow. Hallelujah. They come under the force of the anointing of the Holy Ghost, and men's hearts are driven to great conviction over sin, and revival sweeps the land. That's why we were born. That's where the Constitution came from. These guys say, well, it's a great brilliance. It's a brilliance that happens once every 3,000 years. No, it was a Holy Ghost move of God in the midst of a Holy Ghost revival we call the First Great Awakening in this nation. When Andrew Jackson suddenly stepped up and said, okay, you don't have to own land to vote. You don't have to be a person who's a landowner and have a certain amount of money to vote. Because that was all the people that could vote. They were the only people that could get in the process. He began to create liberties that he began to expand out the liberties to bring everybody in to a democratic process that was written in the Constitution, begin to be expanded. Why? Because there was a second great awakening going on. Because the earth, America, was being shaken by the power of God under a Holy Ghost conviction everywhere. The churches were filled. The lost were coming in by droves. It's going to happen again.
Amen.
I don't need no placard. I don't need no Trump or anybody else in the White House. Huh? In fact, I'm just praying. I'm believing God to do something great before Obama leaves the White House. It doesn't matter who's in the White House. Nothing. Nothing. It's governments of men. It's nothing. There's something far above all the governments of men. Something far superior to all the power of men and all principalities. It's Christ Jesus, the name of Jesus. He, the one who's set above all principalities and powers of mind, dominion, and every name that is named. It's Christ Jesus. And he dwells in the midst of his church, the fullness of him that filleth all things. Hallelujah. Come on. It's just, you're going to have to quit with all this other stuff. You've submitted yourself under wrong authorities. You've submitted yourself to wrong principalities, to wrong principles, to wrong ideas, and thus you governed by them. And being governed by them, you imprisoned by them, you limited, you confined by them. Step out of it into the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free, and be no longer entangled with the yoke of bondage. Step over into this great authority that God has given to you and me, where we can stand in his place and speak his word and make disciples for out of nations, where we can call down the glory of God from heaven so that all men begin to shake under the power of his presence, where the preaching of the word is so strong that in the church conviction falls and men repent and quit living doubled lives. This is why the psalmist said, restore unto me the joy of your salvation. Restore unto me a right spirit. Renew in me a clean heart and a right spirit. Restore unto me the joy of your salvation. Then sinners will be converted and transgressors will be taught your way. Until the church gets it right, there's no sinners going to be converted and no transgressors going to be caught the way, because we live in compromised, double standard lives of hypocrisy. And what matters to Father is more what you're doing in secret than what you're doing right here. More about what's going on in the heartaches for the things that he has declared to be realized in your life, rather than you realizing something more for yourself in this earthly existence, trying to get your stuff. Jesus. At the expense of walking away from the riches that are in Christ Jesus and the riches of heaven. People, it's time we get on the move. It's time we start stirring ourselves up. And the only way you can is that start laying hold on God. He laid hold on you so you can lay hold on him. It's time to get yourself into the Word of God. Get yourself a good diet of the Word of God. I'm going to tell you right now, it's time for you. Some of you need to, listen, I'm going to tell you right now, it'd be good for you, some of you. Just turn your TVs off. Turn your radios off. Turn all the rest of the stuff, all the other distractions off. Get quiet with God. You got so much distraction, so much noise going on, you can't hear nothing from heaven. I'm just telling you, I mean, I recently did it for a big reason. I mean, we had basically cut everything down to nothing, really just minimum of channels to watch the news and whatnot. It's like, I woke up one morning just feeling so strong. Lord, I just don't want any distractions. I don't want anything consuming my time but you. Because I feel such a moving of in my spirit of God calling us to come out from among them, to be consecrated, to be fully given over to those things that he's doing. I'm not telling you necessarily. Well, I should tell you.
But I'm
not telling you necessarily what you need to do about the way you do these kinds of things, because I want the Holy Ghost to be able to talk to you. Because if you just do what I'm telling you to do, then it can become just religious, and it has nothing to do with relationship, because all you're going to do is go read some novel in its place. You know, you just go occupy with other things. Well, Pastor said we can, huh? And Baptist said, we're Baptists, we can't even go to Disney no more. You know, it's just... You know, all these that we can't shop at 7-Eleven, can't go to Starbucks, and Whole Foods is off the list. We can't even get organic anymore because they're supporting something that we're not supposed to be a part of. So we're boycotting them all. No, you're going to have a personal relationship with God, the Holy Ghost, and let him talk to you. Let him talk to you. Let it be out of relationship. There's certain things that we'll tell you. You do these things, you don't do them. The Lord says, listen, if there's anybody who's getting buzzed, don't even have any company with them. I like their sign here in California. It says, if you're driving buzzed, you're driving drunk. They know more than the church knows. Amen. Church is getting buzzed and saying they're not drunk. We're not drunk. We're sipping a little wine like Jesus. Crazy stuff. He says, have no fellowship with them, don't it? If he calls himself a brother and he's getting buzzed. Don't even company with them. Tell them to leave the meeting. You know somebody and they're in adultery and fornication, they won't listen to you. Tell them that they can't come back around until they decide to walk with Jesus. How many churches are doing that? This church will do that. I'll do that. I'll do that. I mean, I'm happy to be long-suffering and merciful. I'm a long-suffering, patient, and merciful people to the nth degree until the Holy Spirit puts the fire on the inside of me, and then I'm saying right now the thunder is going to come because I'm going to obey God. But there's other things that, you know, it really just comes down to where you're going to spend your time. Where are you spending your time? He loves you. You love him. But you're not growing much, and you're not finding yourself captivated with his heart, because it's there that he's going to reveal to you and fill you up with the divine grace and ability to go do what he wants you to do. Because as long as you're being distracted and preoccupied with other things, you're never going to hear his voice. You're going to have to get quiet. Still, my dear, you got to get quiet to hear a still small voice. As long as you're entertained with other things, Father just stand, Holy Ghost just stand in the background. You just stand in the background. What you enjoying, whatever it is you're enjoying. We'll get to you on Sunday morning, Lord. We love you. We don't even get him. They don't even get that much. If we would, I think if more people would give him that much, they'd start thinking about what they're saying. Sorry, Lord, we're real busy right now, but you know, just hang around. We'll get to you later. But you never get to him. They don't even say that much, though. Hello. We want you to step over into a place where your whole identity and purpose and existence for living is to do the will of the Father. Where you're not hearers of the word only, but you doers. Where you become living epistles written of God and read of men. Because this is the gospel. That's what we're talking about in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 that brought us to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. That's now got us over in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, of which I'm going to skip most of them so that I can get to the end here. You know, you guys can go home at a reasonable hour so that you're not absolutely thrashed when you wake up in the morning. But I'm going to tell you right now, very soon, revival's going to come. A moving of God's going to come. It's going to keep you up all night, and you're not going to care about work in the morning.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I tell you right now, if all of you just quit your jobs right now, Father give you insight and direction how to have a better job anyways and make more money and spend less time doing it. But as long as you want to continue to be a slave for peanuts, let's go right on ahead. Because it's just modern slavery. Slavery's been going on for 6,000 years. Men have been subjugating other men. They do it in different ways. The whole system is, people say that there's only a caste system in India. I can prove there's a caste system in America. You, what is written across your resume defines how much money you're going to make at any given time, and you will not have a windfall, which is a cash flow beyond that. You won't have it. It's already decided. It's set in stone. And as long as you're subjugated to that, that's what you're going to be. Your ceiling, I look at some of you and say your ceiling, according to the way the men governed it, is $40,000. Your ceiling is $65,000. Yours is $135,000. And a couple of people in here can go up to $250,000 and beyond because of the caste system. Do you want to live that way? No. That's the way you want to live? Well, then quit living under it. Quit living subjected to it. Quit being so excited about it. Quit being so emotionally upset about the whole thing. Huh? Quit being so distraught over it all. Huh? Quit throwing a fit over it. That's the way it is. Step over into the liberty that Christ Jesus will give you, the provision that he has for you. Come on now. Hallelujah. Come on. Get a little bit of faith in your movement there. Get a little bit of trust in God. Stepping out in the things of the Spirit. This friend of mine I was just saying about, I just love this message about him, because there was a guy that everybody's afraid of. He owns Mississippi. He's worth huge amounts of money. He comes over to my friend's place and he says, listen, we're going to need, and really basically it tallied up probably a couple million dollars worth of things that he had. And so the guy, my friend's, you know, short little Italian guy. And this guy's this big old towering monster, the Mississippi monster. And standing there, you know, doing his thing the way people do that have a lot of money like that. And he starts to talk about business. John says, I don't even want to talk about business. I want to talk about your soul. Are you ready to meet the King of Kings? Are you ready to meet the judge of your life? Are you ready to meet God? Because I'm going to tell you right now, your time's running short. He's got the man under the grip of the Spirit. He don't care about the $2 million. He don't care about his power. He don't care about the doors that he can open. He just cares about preaching the gospel. That's where your business gets promoted, right, left, and center. People are afraid that, I can't talk about Jesus in the business. Well, then you're going to get out of that business. We don't mix God and politics with whatever. What is it? Is that how they, religion and politics? Well, forget about religion anyways. But at any rate, don't talk about religion and politics. Don't talk about politics, but open your mouth and begin to lift up your voice concerning Christ Jesus. If you begin to get sensitive to the Holy Ghost, you'll stand at the cash register and you'll begin to have a burn and a bubble up inside of you for the cash register person. And it may be just something very, very simple, and it may be something very insightful, and it may be something very deep. And she might have to take a break when you finish talking to her because she's a mess. But as long as you're just running your life, doing your own thing, bearing about your own identity in your body, that the life of Christ Jesus cannot be seen. Sure. Are you listening to me? Am I making an impact around here? Yeah. Am I getting anybody convinced of this?
Yes.
2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 4. For the love of Christ constrains us. Whew. Give me a break. The love of Christ Jesus has a grip on our heart, a grip on our life, a grip on our affections, a grip on our emotions, so that we can't do nothing else. The love of Christ Jesus constrains us, because we judge this, that if one died for all, then we're all dead. Listen to this. And that he died for all, that they which live should no longer live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. This is it. I no longer live as Christ Jesus that lives. My whole identity, my whole purpose, my whole mouth, my whole function, my whole being is all about being the instrument of the living God to execute his purpose and will, to declare the glory of his salvation, to help everybody realize that we in transition, all of those things of the world is about to be faded out, and everything that belongs to it is about to come to an eternal end. And I'm here for the sole purpose of lifting up my voice to declare the death and the dying of Jesus. The death of Christ Jesus, to show his death at Calvary's cross. That's bearing the death of Jesus Christ, to show his death at the cross, that his life might also be revealed to me in the signs and wonders and the miracles and the display of the power of the living God, a divine glory. If you remember last time we met, we just talked about beholding the glory, seeing the glory. Father just says, come on, here's how the glory is displayed. It's first of all grabbing hold of that unspeakable gift that has been given to us. This abundant, immeasurable life that has been provided for us, this identity, this place that we have, and this inheritance in him, and saying it's ours and calling it ours and accepting what he's freely given to us. And it's the next step of it. It's just saying, okay, I've accepted it. I believe this. There's no more life for me to live. I've got the life of Christ. Now let's go ahead and begin to obey God and go fully with God, as though this is the first day of your walk with him, with total abandonment. Leave everything behind to come on and follow Jesus. If I could get people to read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and just start obeying everything that they said instead of spinning it to match up their life, everybody in this place would begin to do different things tomorrow. Everyone. Hallelujah. And it'd be a beautiful thing. And you can then prove whether or not God's true. Find out whether or not he's going to provide for you when you step out to live fully for him. But what's happened over the generations is the Lord's had one or two that would go this way. And with one or two, he's got a big job done. But I have an assurance from heaven that it's not going to be that way in the end. Amen. And the culmination of all things. It's not going to be just a few, but it's going to be a great army. It's going to be many. Amen. It wouldn't be terrible if you were just sitting around and all of a sudden you begin to see people who now are just, you know, living like the devil, living full of demon spirits, but suddenly they come into the kingdom of God, and inside of a week they're walking the fullness of the mantle of Jesus Christ and flowing in the authority of heaven, while you're sitting there staring going, why did I get left out? You got left out because you were conflicted. You didn't know which way was up and which way was down, which way was God and which way was the devil. You didn't know which way was living for yourself and which way was fully living for him. I'm not run that risk. I'm not running that. I'll tell you right now, I see somebody outpacing me, I'll pick up the pace. I'm not going to say, oh, wow, they're faster than me. Oh, that's amazing. Somebody said, that's competitive. No, man, I'm not going to be outdone for him. Huh? Because I'm not depending upon my own strength. He gives me strength. He'd give me speed. He'd give me the ability. All that does is provoke me. Huh? I get covetous. Huh? When I get covetous, I lay hold on him. He says, let go, and I say, no. Not till you bless me. I want there to be more than just two or three who believe this and who can receive this. Amen. I want this whole place to come into place. I want this whole place to be able to feel what I'm saying. Because I understand. I know I'm talking over your head. When I'm talking about laying a hold on God, I know I'm talking over your head. I understand that. But I'm seeding you. Amen. And I tell you right now, you don't get to understand it until you go deeper in your relationship. And there's got to be more than just prayer and more than fasting. It's going to be some obedience. There's going to be some stepping out and risking everything. Huh? We're going to be hearing about where you're taking off to go lay down your life for the kingdom. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And it is going to be out of works in that sense. It's not going to be out of some, you know, kind of pressure placed upon you, because the love of Christ will constrain you that you no longer live. Amen. The love of Christ will constrain you that he lives. That you thus judge that if one died for all are dead, that we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves, but live unto him. And we know clearly what it means to live unto him. We know exactly what his purpose for us to go and do. We understand that there are 3 billion people that have not heard the gospel, and I haven't seen anybody get up and leave yet. So in this message, so that condition hasn't changed for a while. Are you listening to me?
Yep.
I was strategizing with some guys the other day. I said, well, you know what? They won't let right now the government, because of the conflict that's going on in Jammu and Kashmir, they won't let us go in there and do a crusade. Because they say we're going to get killed. They won't allow it. They won't allow any advertisement. They won't allow anything. It's got to be undercover. But there is a place in northern India where we can get right up against Jammu and Kashmir. And we can let it rip, man. We can hire buses to go into Jammu and Kashmir and bring them out of Jammu and Kashmir. Hallelujah. Do the same thing in Bhutan. Right now, I've got it. Right up in Sikkim. Does you know the map? Sikkim separates Nepal from Bhutan. You'll die for the gospel right now in Bhutan. You can't do mass evangelism crusade. But I know right now where the national stadium is in Sikkim. We can bus them in from Bhutan. We can bus them in from Bangladesh. We can bus them in from the border towns of India and Nepal, which are radical, radical Hindus, fundamental, I will kill you. Hindus, don't you try to convert anybody, because we the people who got the right way, you're dragging them into hell with your message of salvation and message of Jesus. We can bust them in. Amen. I got the spot right now. I've already got it picked out. I've had it picked out for 3 years. I've been wanting to do Sikkim for 3 years. Nobody's got any money. And I'm just waiting for the faith. I didn't have any money. Nobody had any money when I did Nepal. And when they said, when I finally got that, Nepal door opened up, we were minus 30,000 in debt here. They called me up and they said, the people, literally the people that run the National Estate of Kathmandu, that's the government. They said they want $50,000 now, and you got to have it in here in 24 hours, or you can't have it. And that was after a year of asking and sending people time and time again to ask. And so I said, no, just tell them we'll give in 20. And the person on the other side of the phone said, are you kidding me? This is a miracle that they're even going to let us do this. We've been asking them now for a year. I've been in front of them a dozen times, and now I'm going to go back for 20? I said, go tell them 20, because that's what I had faith for, and I didn't have 20. I was minus 30,000. They said 20, but it's got to be here before the morning. I didn't have 20. You know what I did? I was busy in a meeting. I went in the meeting, just worshiped God, praised God. I forgot all about any responsibilities. Hallelujah. Katabona Shangeya Potolamaya. Hallelujah. Habana Resita. Mongadea Past. Came out of the meeting. God gave me a word of knowledge. $20,000 was sent to them. And so I'm waiting for that. I mean, I don't want to be waiting. I believe the Sikkim should have happened. Three years ago. I believe that the meeting in Kyrgyzstan should have happened 5 years ago. I can go down the line. I was telling Joe and Becky, I was there in 2007 saying, look, in 2008 in Shanghai, let's take the Shanghai Crusade Stadium, 70,000 people, and let's just do a great gospel musical there. Because you can do it in Shanghai. You can do a musical, gospel musical. And I couldn't get anybody to agree with me in China. They said, well, we can't do that. We're all concerned, this and that. I didn't have anybody stand with me there to do it. The Mormons came and did it. Mormons got money. I'm just talking about you and I just getting so deep into the realms of the life of Christ Jesus that the things of heaven can abundantly flow to us, and we're not living over here in this little poverty situation. This little lack and confinement and can't hardly move outside of our own, you know, block on the street and go from house to the work and back to the house and the church and frown when we go through the bread line. You know what I'm saying? At the grocery store, because we all burdened down with our self-interest. No life. We're bearing about in our body our own self-interest so that the life of Jesus Christ cannot be revealed. That's the Antichrist gospel. I'm just going to keep repeating myself till I feel like I've been heard. I'm going to skip over a bunch of stuff here. Go to chapter 11 real quick. Let's look at how much fun Paul was having. Jesus. Hallelujah. He says in verse 23, just give you a short version. Verse 23 of 2 Corinthians chapter 11, he said, for the ministry of Christ, are they the ministers of Christ? He said, I speak like someone who's a moron. Now, that's really, the Greek word is the word that we use for moron, is the Greek word morun, the Arabic moron, both of them mean fool. I speak as a moron, a moru, or a fool. I'm more, because he's saying, are they the ministers of Christ? Yeah, right. That's what he's saying. I am more. In labors, more abundant. In stripes, above measure. Listen to him now. Come on. In prison, more frequent. This sounds like somebody from China. It sounds like somebody from Kashmir. This sounds like somebody from North Korea. This sounds like somebody from Bhutan. This sounds like somebody from the Sudan. Someone from Chad. Listening to me. Algeria. Come on, man. Saudi Arabia. The area region around Mecca. There's churches in Mecca. And it's pretty, pretty hostile. Because I know some people that are serious blabbermouths for Jesus who have resigned themselves completely over to death. They don't have a problem walking up to a woman veiled in a burqa and saying, Jesus Christ is standing at the door of your heart knocking. Will you open up and let him in? Huh? To then be beaten up because he's talking to a woman. Huh? Come on now. What you going to do tomorrow as you tiptoe through the tulips? Try not to offend anybody. Trying to make friends. I hope they like me. Oh, I hope when I see, I hope they like me. Well, I'm not going to get into it. I'm going to try to breathe. He says, of the Jews, this is the impact or the response to his Holy Ghost message. Five times I received 40 stripes, save one. Five times, 40 stripes. Five times. Those that you're supposed to not be able to live through one. His back was pulverized. He was beaten 40 stripes, five different occasions. Think of it, people. This is how they received the message he preached. Huh? I don't have any worries about the frowns and the rejection of slow bleed, people leaving out the building. I haven't been whipped yet. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked at night and was spent a day in the deep. In journeyings often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils. I'm going to tell you right now, many people would tell you he must not have been saved. He was... If he would have been walking with God a little bit closer, it wouldn't have been happening. But listen to him. He's bragging. He's describing and declaring how he bears in his body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, always being given over to death, living always confronting death continually. And in that threatening situation, in that risky place, that's where Jesus is revealed. I tell people all the time, you want more of anointing? Go get yourself in trouble for preaching the gospel. Not in this humanistic society of America. Ain't nobody going to really do anything other than talk bad about you. Tell you you shouldn't be talking like that. Maybe they might dial 911 potentially now because of all call the Homeland Security.
But I know much is going to happen to you.
They might take you in and ask you a few questions. Huh? Make sure you don't have a gun, start killing everybody or something. In peril of my own countrymen. In peril. You know what peril means? They're about ready to kill you. Are you with me? Have you talked to someone recently about Jesus and they said they're about ready to kill you? We need to get you in this situation. We want you to get you in the ministry of Jesus because everybody's going to want to kill Jesus. And see, and look at that. Jesus didn't have to pack a gun. Huh? He just disappeared out of their hands because it wasn't time yet. His day had not come. His hour had not come. He could have called 12 legions of angels anytime. Somebody said, how many is a legion? Could be upwards of 6,500, depending on what region of the Roman Empire we're talking about, legion. Could be anywhere from 1,000 to 6,500, depending. So let's just go with the 6,500 number. One angel will destroy a whole nation of people. The angels bore him up in their hands so they wouldn't even stub his toe. Huh? But then the Lord allowed him to be handed over. But he was always being threatened. Death was always right there. Death was always, if you open up your mouth, you're going to die. If you open up your mouth, they're going to throw you in jail. They're going to torment you. They're going to torture you. I know people who live this way. Chan and Holly. I was telling you, I couldn't get a hold of him. I was concerned, what's going on with Chen? If you read Brother Yun's book, The Heavenly Man, when the prison doors opened for him, supernaturally, there was a taxi cab out there to pick him up. They took him to two girls' house. That's Chen and Holly. They're close friends of ours. I couldn't get a hold of Holly. I'm like, what's going on, man? I'm just email after email. I'm like, what on earth? And I was trying to go around and ask different people. Last week, or week before last, I got a message from her. She says, Pastor Mark. Markamush. Eh? Markamush. No, it's Chinese. Yeah. You're still in Japan. We're in China. Markamush, which means Pastor Mark. I just got out of jail. I've been in prison since June. They told me they were holding me indefinitely, and they weren't going to let me out. And God supernaturally delivered me. And some of the things I can't say, camera's on. I don't know if people live like this. But we sit over here in our little comfort zone doing whatever it is we're saying we're doing for the kingdom of God, that most of it can never be verified in the Bible. What we're saying we're doing for the kingdom. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Come on then. When are we going to conform to the Word? Conform to Jesus. He's the living Word. The living Word is the expression of the written Word. I'm telling you, there's people standing way beyond, head and shoulders beyond anything that we do in the kingdom right now. They're laying down their life. And it's time somebody around here steps up, and he's up. Huh? Starts following him. Come on now. Look at all the fun Paul's having. In weariness. No, I didn't get all the rest of this. In peril of heathen, in peril of the city, in peril of the wilderness. In peril, what's peril of the wilderness? We don't have any water. Where is the next water hole? In peril, in perils in the sea, in perils of false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often and hunger, in thirstings and fasting often, in cold and in nakedness. Whew. Besides those things which are without, those that come upon us daily, the care of all the churches. That's the way I want to live. That's the way I'm going to live. I want you to look around your life, and I want you to take inventory on all the things that is affixed to your heart and attached to your heart you can't live without. And I want you to be honest with God. All the things that are your treasures on this earth, and that's got your heart captivated. And I'm praying in the name of Jesus, you'll get your treasures moved from the earth to the heaven, so your heart be there too, so Christ Jesus can begin to be revealed in your life, and so that a motivation from heaven can begin to take hold of your life, and you begin to move out in the things that the Spirit of the Lord would create within you to do. I'm not talking about somebody doing something out of their own ideas and out of their own, ambition for the kingdom of God. I'm talking about you letting God, in a relationship with him, you letting Jesus become so big to you that his living his life is so much better to you than anything else. Here's Paul going through all this. Is he saying, I'm so bummed out. Listen to me. Is Paul saying, I'm so bummed out? He said, no. He said, I've suffered the loss of everything and count it but dung. That's how he felt about it. House dung. Chariot dung. Huh? He came from a wealthy family. He was a Roman citizen. His parents were out of Tarsus. Jews. Set at the feet of Gamaliel. Best schools. Rich. Okay? Wealthy family. Guarantee you. He said, I've suffered the loss of everything and count it but dung, that I might win Jesus. And we're all upset at the praise and worship didn't go according to our liking. The sound was a little bit too loud. All I could hear was the drums. And that's about the intensity of our peril. I was threatened. My eardrum. While everybody was screaming, the person was screaming. I'm telling you, they were screaming right in my ear. I think I have eardrum damage. I have had someone tell me that. Well, what were they screaming about? The person was worshiping the Lord, you deadhead. Can't you believe that God could take care of your ears to begin with? Is this all we've got to be concerned about? You in the wrong church. Conclusion. No, honestly, where is our situation? What are we doing with our lives? What are we doing with our lives? What are we doing with our lives? What are you doing with your life? So he said, oh, I'm calling you tonight to not try to put on something that you're not clothed with. I'm calling you to come into a place with God where you can get yourself clothed. Because I'm telling you right now, the one who made this big on the inside of me, Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. He said, I labored more abundantly than everyone, but not me. The grace of God that is on the inside of me. Father wants you to come into a relationship deep enough to where that you with total abandonment forsake everything that you hold on to and follow him. But I'm going to tell you right now, some of you are going to die old in your house in a stale, moldy place and have done nothing more for Jesus than what you've already done. You're running the risk. And if somebody said that me, I said that about me, and I thought that that was true, I'd start tearing my clothes off. I tell you right now, I guarantee you I would. I'd start. You talk. I don't need to rend the heavens. I rend my heart. You hear me? I'd make it. I'd make it known. I'm telling you right now. I pray that you would have a response. Nobody had to tell me go preach. Nobody had to tell me to be at church on time. Nobody had to tell me come worship the Lord. Nobody had to tell me come hunger and thirst after righteousness. God, the Holy Ghost came on the inside of me and began to live. Hallelujah. Nobody had to babysit me, try to encourage me. Oh, did your feathers get ruffled in the meeting? My heart, my attitudes, let the righteous smite me. It'd be health unto me. I'm hungry and thirsty after the things of God. Tell me what I need to do to change. So I can be right with God. Speak into my life. Come on, man. Self-preservation gets you nowhere. Quit bearing about in your body your own self-interest so that the life of Jesus cannot be revealed. Let's turn the thing around. Start bearing in your body the death of Jesus Christ. What is the death of Jesus Christ? I want to be very real with you, okay? I want to be very real. His crucifixion. When you see me, you see Jesus crucified. That's what Paul's saying. When you see me, you see Jesus crucified. I'm all about it. I'm going to take you right to the cross where he was crucified, for I'm crucified with him. I bear in my body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not only handed over to death, not always living on the verge of being killed, because I'm preaching to the people where you're not allowed to preach. They forbid me to preach here. They forbid Paul to preach. You know where he would go? He'd go stand up on the porch of the temple and start preaching. James and Peter said, get him out of here. He's going to get us all killed. Send him to Tarsus. He's right in the big middle. Everywhere they were gathered together, he said, you guys, he would lay it on them big time. He'd go right into the temple, preach in the temple. He'd get their crowds together. They sent him home to Tarsus, and he obeyed. He went home to Tarsus. He's come out of an abundance of revelation, got the full download of heaven, 3 years in Arabia, comes to Jerusalem. He's fit to be tied. You can't tie him. You know, he's fit to be tied, but you can't tie him. But he submitted. They said, no, you're going to get us all killed. You go back home to Tarsus. You can't stay here. You go preach in Tarsus. There is nothing that could stop him. There is nothing that could stop him. Every movement, everything that was happening, he took it as the shaping hand of the Father preparing him for greatness. And here is his statement. In the midst of all this, he's gone through all this. Here's what he says. He says this to the church at Philippi. He said that I may know him. I look at people all the time and I see them. They're in their great need for a move of God in their life. And I say to them, the Lord Jesus wants you to know. And they respond to me, oh, I know him. That tells me right there that they don't really know him at all. Paul, the aged Paul, says, oh, that I may know him. The right response would have been, a heart response of the Holy Ghost would have been, I want to know him. Whatever it takes, I want to know him. That would have been a right response. That would have been a yielded heart. God can do a lot with that. But this other thing is a resisting the Spirit of the Lord. He says, oh, that I may know him. in the fellowship of his sufferings. This is after 2 Corinthians chapter 11, by the way. Oh, that I may know him in the fellowship of his sufferings. Oh, that I might be right there standing with him, speaking what he said that caused all the suffering to come upon him. May I be right there and for the sake of the gospel, showing forth the love of the Father, reaching out to rebellious and sinful and wicked man, fellowship with all that he had to go through. You listening to me? Because we don't want to do that. Won't ruffle any feathers. We got to have friends. Friendship with the world is an act of hostility, an act of an enemy of God. No. That ain't having friends. That's serving yourself. That's heaping under your... That's trying to fill a big empty hole inside of you that God wants to come and fill. Huh? It's a need. It's a need that belongs to the realm of the earthly and maybe even the realm of the demonic. You listen to me. God wants you to be able to move past. He wants you to have enough authority that you can move past the intimidation. And you can move past the fear. And you can move past the threatenings of men. And the restrictions that the culture and the principality and power of the air put on you. Oh, you can't talk about God around here. Oh, it's business time. Separate the ministry from the business. Nonsense. If you were a pastor and a leader in a ministry and you had been involved in business, then yeah, you could do that to some degree. You have to distance yourself from that. But that's another issue altogether. That I may know him. How? By fellowshipping with his sufferings. Oh, I want to know him, but I want no fellowship with no sufferings. We're believing God for a bigger house. We think that Father would be glorified if we could move up from a 5,000 square foot house to a 50,000 square foot, because I heard about this guy who's he's following the devil, and if the devil could bless him with that, you know, $100 million home, what would God do for us? That he might show forth his glory. It's another gospel, man. We're not talking about that. We're not talking, and that ain't even in the Bible. You know, that is so far from the Bible, you can't see it. Jesus help us. That I may know him in the fellowship of his sufferings. How do you get that? By doing what he's doing. By being so constrained by the love of God that you must go. That with the same love that he went with. The same love's on the inside. See, the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in me and should have a result and an impact that is similar to that which was going on in his life. As he was moved by the Holy Ghost and the compassions of the Father. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me? That I may know him in the fellowship of his sufferings. And that's nothing to do with what Sister Sally said to Sister Sue about you. It has nothing to do about the disease that you allowed Satan to invade your life with. That ain't no sufferings. Jesus wasn't sick one day. Amen.
Amen.
Come on. All these crazy notions that people have to excuse themselves from total abandonment of pursuing their own interest in life, to come and live big for the kingdom of God. You have a short opportunity to live big for the kingdom of God. Paul said, I'm in a strait between two opinions, between two being in two states. He said, I want to stay in the body for your sake to help you, but I really want to die and leave here to be present with the Lord. Me, I'm afraid I'm going to have to say something a little different. I don't want to go right now because I haven't done even a fraction of what needs to be done in the following of Jesus. I don't feel like I barely make the cut. I don't want to be ashamed. I don't want to be one of those people escaped, you know, saved by the skin of your teeth. Slipped into heaven on a banana peel. I don't want to be one of those guys. They were saved as by fire. Just barely made it in. Sliding into home base. I don't want to. I don't want to be you know, in the club with the thief on the cross. That I may know him in the fellowship of his suffering. This is a consecration. You want to come do this? Can you do this tonight? Because this passion and this love will get you past all your fears and intimidations of why you don't talk to people. There's some of you who've been around people for months, maybe even some of you for years, and you've never confronted them about the fact that they're going to spend an eternity in a place called hell if they continue to reject and refuse the love of God. Why? Because you're living under the gag order and the influence of a demon power that demands that you not speak that name, Jesus. Ruth and Anna, I was talking about this. She's so set that people are not going to... You guys are blessed to have Ruth Anna mentoring you. She's set that she's not going to have anybody who cannot give a five-minute passionate display of the message of Jesus Christ at an altar call that convicts the hearts of men. Some half-hearted little expression of a something barely can even understand, didn't even know if it was what it was, an altar call or what it was. Huh? And a 10-minute sermon. I mean, there's so many people, that isn't even on their priority list. That's not even on their bucket list. You know what I'm saying? They have a fiery authority to speak the word of God because they don't have that kind of relationship. They don't have that kind of depth. They've never had that kind of submission. You don't have submission to the people that God's placing over you. You don't have submission to God. And that's why you don't have a fire coming out of your mouth, an authority coming out of your spirit. You listen to me. Because anybody can have this. Anybody can have this. Anyone can have this. And it don't take no 3 years either. Huh? It takes just a little bit of brokenness before the presence of the Lord. And the life of Jesus Christ becomes fully lived. And now you, it's the spirit of your Father speaking in you. You don't all imprisoned by everybody's opinion under the self-conscious and whatever, you know, barely can even speak the name of Jesus. If you had settled in your heart tonight that you may know him in the fellowship of his suffering. See, we get to speak the truth in love. It's not a harshness. It's a boldness. It's a glory. It's a majesty. It's a splendor. It goes right to the hearts of people. It's a compassion. It comes upon the wings of compassion. It flows in the rivers of divine love. These words of grace that are uttered forth from my mouth by the Holy Ghost. Not some religious ideology. Not punching some religious time clock. Not some have-to. Not some legal responsibility. But a relationship that has constrained us, that compels us, that moves us with the same heart that moved the Father to send his only begotten Son to lay down his life for the sins of the world. So we gladly go and lay down our lives too. That's bearing the death. You hear me? That's bearing the caring about the death of the Lord Jesus Christ in our body. As he came to give his life to the world. That's what John said. If he laid down his life for us, how much more should we lay down our life for the brethren? And that is a big thing right there. There are so many people in the house of God today. They don't know how to love them. They don't know how to love them that love those that love them. They don't even know how to serve those who are worthy of double honor. They don't even know how to submit to those who have been by works proven to be the servants of the Lord, speaking on behalf of the Lord. How much less can they then go love those who hate them and go love those who want to persecute them and destroy them? Huh? See, the enemy has been able to run amok in the place because people haven't been able to understand who they are and what they've been called to do and the life that they've been given when they were crucified with Christ. They want to hold on to their own life. They've got their whole mansions developed for them and their whole concept of their existence and their retirement. Writing a 30-year plan for your life ought to be the easiest thing you can do. Huh? Because you've already picked the nations you want to go lay down your life for. You've already picked out the things you want to see God do in the United States of America and other nations through your life. I mean, my goodness gracious. You've already picked it all out in detail. How many souls you want God to you, the authority and the power and the anointing and the expression of His Word and of His life and the gifts of the Spirit that you want to see come full maturity in your life. The whole dimension of all that Jesus described in the Word. Many people say, write your 30-year plan. They look at me with cross eyes, and then the things roll up inside their head. What are you saying? And the first thing they're thinking about is things that they should be the last things, because there'd be no concern at all. Well, how about our house? How about our nest egg? You're not a bird. Or a chicken. You know what I'm saying? How about our retirement plan? I got a retirement plan for you. As soon as you get so old, you can't hardly move around, go to the most hostile nation and preach the gospel.
Amen.
Hallelujah. There's countless thousands of people that would give their life to Jesus if you would sort through it tonight. There's people taking their life all over the place right now. Millions by every second go into eternity without God. And we live under the intimidation, the fear, and the gag order of Satan because we have too many earthly interests. And through those earthly interests, Satan can impose upon us his restriction. And when you all of a sudden discover that that's keeping you from the intimacy that God has provided for you to have through Christ Jesus, you're going to get yourself up and moving. And there's going to be some serious fiery looks in your eyes. And you're going to quit laying down to anything. Hallelujah. And you're going to start saying, I am. I said, I am, so I am. That's it. Hallelujah. Puck hold on. We start kicking stuff around, I guarantee you. You'll lay hold on Him. He's laid hold on you so that you might lay hold on Him. That I may know Him in the fellowship of His sufferings. I pray tonight that every one of you want to know Him. I pray tonight that every one of you will say, oh, be able to come to a place, oh, I am aspiring to come to a place where I have suffered the loss of everything. Oh, yeah. I'm aspiring to have everything that belongs to treasure being in heaven and not on this earth. So I aspire to come into a place of suffering the loss of everything. And count it but dumb, because I'm romancing Jesus. Yes. That's what he says, that I may win him. I'm romancing Jesus. And he's been preaching now. He's about ready to die. This is later on in his life. This is at the conclusion of his ministry. Come on, people. I'm talking to you here tonight. God, the Holy Ghost, is talking to you here tonight. That I may know him, the fellowship of his suffering. Listen to this. Being made conformable unto his death. Same thing you just said over there in 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Being conformed to his death. Being in every way conformed to his death. In every way my life hid in Christ. In every way I don't exist and I don't live. In every way being nothing more than a declaration of Christ Jesus and him crucified. Knowing nothing but him and Christ Jesus and him crucified. That this is words of, it's what comes out of my mouth every time I speak. If you don't do this, you listen to me, if you don't do this, what's going to happen is you're going to run the risk of falling in love with the pleasures of this world and ultimately having pleasures in unrighteousness, and your eternity is a terrible fate. You do not want to miss heaven. You cannot afford to miss heaven. Neither can you afford to spend an eternity in a place where Satan is confined to. We're begging you to come begin to understand what we're saying, that I may know him in the fellowship of his suffering, that I may be conformed unto his death, that if by any means possible, listen to the urgency, listen to the intensity, listen to the passion, listen to the prayer, that if by any means possible, I too may attain. Well, I thought it was a free gift. It is, but listen to the passion of Paul who preached that it was a free gift. Yeah. And people need to understand that they take verses of Scripture out of isolation and try to make their whole ideology centered around that, and they don't take the whole counsel of God and recognize that if you listen to the whole story, because you're not getting the dialogue with Paul, you'll understand more about the meaning of what it is that he's saying in the various different places that he expresses the different things that he says, that I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. It's a grand prize. It's the great prize. It's the price that we press in. It's that desire that we have. It's that message of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, where there was some acting as though that they'd already received the resurrection. He said, I protest that you're rejoicing, I die daily. My body is a corpse. Every day I grow weaker. Every day the hourglass of time is running out for me, and this body's coming to an end. I'm about to lay it down and breathe out my last breath, and then it's eternity. Very soon you're approaching the day. The hourglass of your time and of your life is running out. You're approaching the day that you're going to breathe out your last breath. We want you to go from life to life. We want you to understand that you pass from death unto life so that you might go from life to life. Jesus said, he that believes on me shall never see death. And he's saying, when you go and you begin to make the transition from this life into the next life, it's going from life to life. And he's going to come and get me. He said, in my Father's house is many mansions. If you were not told so, I would not have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And I come to receive you into myself, that where I am, you may be with me also. I got a promise. Somebody said, oh, that isn't what I mean. It's what it means to me. He's going to come and get me. Oh, well, the angels come get you. Jesus is going to come get me. I'm in love with Jesus. I don't care nothing about nothing except for him. Listen, that's not good English. Who cares? I don't care nothing about anything. Jesus. And out of that realm, he causes me to have his care. And that's the only real care. And out of that, I have a compassion and a love for people. You know what? And I'm more interested in your soul. I'm more interested in you giving your life over to the Lord and rather than you liking me or honoring me or respecting me. I'm going to tell you what your problem is. Huh? And I might not get it exact, but I'll hit on it. I guarantee you, I'll push the button. And you'll know I pushed the button because you'll probably stagger in it for a couple of days. Yeah. Try to justify yourself and wiggle your way out of it. Huh? Out of what God's trying to tell you, what the Holy Ghost is trying to place on you for your own benefit. He's trying to place it on you for your own benefit. The Lord's going to give you an opportunity just to live big for him, to live a blessed and wonderful life. Let nothing in this world have any place to touch your emotions. What makes everybody else sad? You don't even notice it. What distresses everybody else? You didn't even know it existed.
Yeah. Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
What everybody's all wrapped around of? You don't even care anything about.
Yeah.
Has no meaning to you.
Sure.
Huh?
Yeah.
Huh?
Mm-hmm.
It's like dog food. You have no desire for it. Who wants that? I would have eaten steak. I'm having Wagyu. Jesus. Father's calling us to place. I'm just here with Jesus. I'm here with Jesus. I'm here with the Holy Ghost, wanting him to be able to do something in our lives, to move things around, to reposition things in our lives so that he can do what it is he wants to do.
Yeah.
Huh? If he says, I want you to sit over here and you guys move over here, whatever the rearrangement is he needs, whatever attitude adjustments he needs, because your attitude is going to have huge impacts on what you can do both in this life and in the life that is to come. Your thinking, your decision is going to have huge impacts on what God's able to do with you, how freely God the Holy Ghost is able to come and reveal Jesus to you. It needs to get right. It needs to be straightened out. You need to begin to live by the Word of God. Listen, I'm telling you right now, all of your perception, all your beliefs are colored by your ideologies, and you have them, believe it or not. And ideologies are equal to idols as far as I'm concerned. And Father wants those things tore down. your own bias, your own preconceived ideas, the opinions that you have that has been developed out of the way that you were raised, the way that you were culturized in the United States of America. You filter everything and all actions and all those things that God would do in a kingdom realm. You try to filter them through the democracy, so to speak, that you were raised in. And the only way you're going to get out of that mess is to start living under the authority of the Word of God, believing His Word, making those adjustments that He commands to make. Hallelujah. Sukara mastaderi nakaseya. Bondarestaki. Besti pranamakateya.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. If I could just convince you tonight to step over with me. Leave this life and step into the heavenly one. Leave your own life and step over into His life. Not partially, but with total abandonment. It's not something that you've got to earn or try to produce. It's a gift. It's better than a coat of many colors. It's a mantle and a life that He wants to endue you with. Where you put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Literally put Him on and be endued with Him. Immediately when you put on the Lord Jesus Christ, you bear in your body His death and you bear in your body His life. Well, it sounds like a paradox, but it's not. Both coexist. You can't have one without the other. To recognize that you've been delivered over to death, because that's the same word that is used for Jesus being delivered over. It's mostly translated, that verse in 11, verse 11 of 2 Corinthians 4, being delivered over to death. It's the same word that is used and translated by the King James in the night that He was betrayed. That word is paradidomai. The Greek word is paradidomai. And it means to be handed over or to be delivered over. We've been delivered over to death. And it harkens back and specifically is only really used over and over again in the four Gospels, paradidomai. It's used over and again in the four Gospels as Jesus being delivered over to death when He was taken and scourged and crucified. That wasn't accidentally done by Paul. It was intentional. It was driving home the point. Verse 11, fully expressing verse 10. And He's telling you and me what we have signed up for. And He's bringing it home to a place that we can be fully conscious of our commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. And now, in turn, having now become fully aware of what it is God has purposed for our lives, begin to ask the Holy Ghost to give us the ability, to give us the strength, to give us the understanding, to give us the fire, the power, the glory, the divine wisdom and insight to do it. Come on, people. All you got to do is open up your mouth and get real with God. I'm going to say it one more time. This is what the Lord spoke to me today, to deliver to you, been delivered to me. No man has anything to give unless he's first received it from heaven. Yes. You listen to me. God laid hold on you that you might lay hold on Him. Yes. Listen to me, Kelly. God laid hold on you that you might in turn lay hold on Him. That is a passion. That is a determination. That's a sold out heart. It said, I don't care what it takes. I'm going to be what God said I am. I'm going to do what God called me to do. Amen.
Amen.
Everybody, would you stand with me? We come before the Lord as we did on the first day, just as I am, without one plea. But that your blood was shed for me. We come, it's the first time we've ever heard about Him, ever stirred by the Holy Ghost to respond to Him. We stand here tonight just the same way. Nothing's changed. It's still all going to be by His power, by His grace, by His mercy, but it's still going to be by our willingness and our response to accept and receive and believe and do what it is that he said for us to do. Father stands waiting. It's not us that stands waiting. It's Father stands waiting. Father has poured out heaven. And I'm telling you right now, I feel heaven in this place. I feel transition in this place. I feel the things of this world. I feel the lust of this world and the things of this world being broken off of God's people so that they may begin to fully express those things that belong to heaven, because you're never going to be able to have both of them at the same time. You'll either have hell or you'll have heaven. You're not going to have hell and heaven. They're not going to mix. You're either going to have the full expression of God, or it's just simply going to be a stronghold of the enemy. Because you're not going to sit down and have communion with devils and somehow sit at the table of the Lord. Let's come sit at the table of the Lord. He set a feast before us. He's prepared a table. And the master invites us. He says, come and dine. People, you're going to have to recognize that God is who he says he is in Christ Jesus. Is the Savior. There is no other means of salvation but by him. He is the only means. Until you turn yourself over and call upon his name and turn yourself over to him, you're dead in your sins. You're under the authority and the strongholds of the powers of darkness. It's time you recognize that now, having been born again, your citizenship is in heaven. You belong to God. You're a part of a new race. You belong to the kingdom of God. It has a different function. It has a different rule. It has a different way, a different life. And Father doesn't want to mix with the world and human opinion. He wants you to let God, the Holy Spirit, show you how to live this life and walk this way. So he set up his church. He put gifts in his church, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. He placed in the midst of the church the great outworking of the Holy Ghost power that Jesus might be fully revealed, as he placed in the midst of the church miracles and gifts of healing and governments. Governments that are higher than the governments of men. The governments of men will be destroyed and brought to an end, but this government that God has placed in his church has no end. And the increase of his government has no end. It's continually increasing. You decide. Are you going to be religious? Are you going to be denominational? Are you going to believe what different people say about God? Are you going to turn to the Word of God and submit yourself to the Word of God and recognize that the Word of God, the written Word of God, was made manifest in the living Word, Christ Jesus, so that nobody can mistake what God's will is for our lives? Yes, there are things that Jesus allows us to do that he didn't do. He allows us to marry and have a family. But he expects us in that marriage and in that family to be wholly given over to the kingdom of God, to train up our children in the fear and the admonition of the Lord, to bring in families that are totally submitted to the culture of the kingdom, whose lives and purpose is nothing more than to perpetuate the ongoing ministry of the gospel of the Lord Jesus till he comes. This church is going to become a radical soul-winning church. Because we're going to give ourselves completely over to the life of Jesus and the ministry of the Holy Ghost. There is a message of salvation, a message of the gospel, that the majority of people have never heard because it's never been said in the depths of the love of the Spirit of God. They've heard it spoken out of in the terminology and the voice of religion and in the passion of men, but they've never really heard the gospel ministered in the depths of the beauty of the Holy Ghost, and that which the Spirit of the Lord speaks and says and does. I'm telling you right now, God's looking for some people who will speak his word that he may confirm his word with signs following. God's looking for some people that will fully represent him, not in part. I'm telling you, Father's rearranging everything. He's rearranging everything. Father is going to give himself over and has already for the purpose of his son being glorified. He's set for that. And I praise God that every one of you, just like Anna, are really learning how to pay attention in church. To be a part and participate with the moving of the Spirit of God, and not to be wiggly and distracted. Not be wanting to go run off and do your own thing, but recognize that there's a holy thing going on. That the living Word's coming on the inside of you and is working effectually or mightily in you that will believe. This is just an opportunity to listen to somebody else give another lecture, another speech. This is the time where the Word of God, Spirit of God, begins to birth within your spirit. The things of heaven begins to move within your being with divine inspiration and seed you with His purpose and create divine ability. Father, I give myself completely to You. Resign my life over to You, Father, in every way. Lord, and I do that with such thanksgiving. Father, I pray tonight that every person in this place will be able to hear Paul saying, in all my affliction and all my tribulation, I'm exceeding glad. Because it doesn't matter what the suffering is that's going on in this life, it's not worthy to be compared with the glory that's about to be revealed in my life. It's not worthy. It's not worthy. It's not worthy. When we give our life, when you give your life to Jesus, you will be persecuted. You will be rejected for saying what He demands you to declare, for living the way He demands you to live, for doing the things He commands you to do, for being who He created you to be. But it's not worthy to be compared. It's not worthy to be compared. The thought of going to Kashmir and dying a martyr's death for Jesus, to stand in the company that He stands in, Jesus is the first martyr. I mean, there were other prophets who came in before Him that were there testifying to Him that were also stoned. Isaiah, according to tradition, was sawed in two. But Jesus is the leader of the company of the martyrs. And yeah, everyone who's been born again is given power to be a martyrus, a witness, having lost your life. But in a beautiful way, having lost your life in exchange to have His life. The thought of being able to go and in the midst of the glory of God being revealed, Father, with purpose, choose me, receive a martyr's crown. Give me a you talk about Holy Ghost promotion. You live on that for ages. But Papa put this in my heart as a young man, as a little guy, as 4 years old. I told my mother I was going to go give my life to be martyred, that I'd die as a martyr, unreached people, ministering the unreached people groups. She said, oh, son, you don't need to think about that right now. That all belongs to the Lord. Papa puts in our hearts at a very young age. Some of us just born for this. I just reckon that everybody in this place is just born for this. You couldn't be hanging around me unless those things that God has placed in my life, He had purposed to reproduce in you. What God's placed in my life is His only begotten Son, His divine word and purpose. You don't even have no business being here unless what God's given me should be reproduced in your life. Hallelujah. That's just the way it is. That's the only reason you're here. Otherwise, you'd be over where somewhere else where somebody, that God put in somebody else's life be reproduced in your life. Somebody thought, I don't want anybody else to be reproduced. But that's just the way the kingdom of God is. God does families. He does families. Huh? He does families. God does families. He does parents. He does children. Praise God. Amen. He reproduces and multiplies after its kind. Yes. And what I see being reproduced is a vision for the nations. a radical willingness to lay down your life at any cost for the cross. And I tell you right now, I see it in Cade and Ruth. I see it. I know. I mean, it's like, you know, when the Lord put my heart to go to Kashmir end of May, I'm thinking, well, Lord, should I take Ann? It's really very dangerous. I can kind of put on a skull. I can grow my beard out a little bit, put on a skull cap, and really blend. No, I look like those guys there. I do. I look like those guys. Ann? White eyes, big time. She glows. She's so white, she glows. See, I mean, now she's so full of Holy Ghost, she glows. Bottom line, she's like, you're not leaving me behind, you know. And then Ruth, Anna, and Cade said, look, can we go? I'm saying, Lord. Because you just started thinking, well, you know, me laying down my life is one thing. Bringing the kids along, lay down their lives, that takes another level. And it's like, yeah, no problem. Come, let's do it. I want you to pray because Nepal, if Nepal is unwilling, they're afraid. They don't want to do the crusade in March in Western Nepal. But without a crusade, without the power of the gospel, confronting the powers that would take Nepal from a secular nation back into a religious nation, they're going to begin to prevail. And Nepal will be thrown back into it, can potentially be, I don't want to say it, but they could potentially be thrown back into another war. I was trying to remind those guys today, don't you remember you were in a 40-year war? You are being oppressed by the Hindu government. I stood on a platform and with an open vision said that the war comes to an end and that the government will recognize the church as an ally, not a foe. And within 3 months it happened. Don't you get it? The power of the gospel is the only means to confront opposing power. It ain't going to get better without the gospel. Why retreat back to your fear? Oh, we're going to die. Well, I'll die. I'm the biggest target. Hide behind me. I want you to pray because we want to do, we have no fear.
Amen.
We bear in our body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ that the life of Jesus may be revealed in us. Have no fear. Hallelujah. Kato Ramanja say it. Not a bullet cannot hit me. Unless the Lord says, come here. Hallelujah. And he needs me too much right now. Because there are very few of me even standing on this planet. There are very few people who preach the word of God without compromise. I feel very safe. I feel very safe. He needs me.
Yeah. Me too.
Amen. So I said, that's a pretty boastful thing to say. It's called laying hold on God. Because the laborers are few. Now, if there was an abundance of laborers and I was somehow could find myself as redundant, then I wouldn't say that. But I don't find myself that at all. Not even close. And I believe in Jesus' name, every one of you will have the same testimony. And then I'll see you over in glory, and it'll be a big high five in the Holy Ghost. We did it. We went all the way. We run the race. We kept the faith. We fought the fight. Hallelujah. Henceforth is laid up for us a crown of righteousness which should not fade away. It's not long from now. It's not long. It's not long from now. I have to ask her at the end how old she is because I can't even imagine she's 23, 24. I was going to say 22. So that's what I'm saying. It was just yesterday. It was yesterday. It was just yesterday. Tomorrow, I'm going to be breathing out my last breath. This morning I was thinking about Elizabeth. And then I had this spanker. She's 3 years old running around in the church getting in mama's purse, telling me she needs some money. What do you need to buy? You don't get in your mama's purse unless you ask her first. I was thinking, I wish I hadn't spanked her for that. I just swatted her a little bit. Said, don't get in your mom's purse. Look at her. I don't even know how old she is. I don't think about it. Tomorrow, we breathe out our last breath. Another moment, and we're in eternity. You think you got a lot of time. No, you don't. I pray in the name of Jesus that you'll be able to number your days. Talk about making a 30-year plan. Number your days. How many days do you have left, in other words? That's far beyond making a 30-year plan. Number your days that you may apply your heart unto wisdom. Wisdom says, they that love me, I love them. And they that seek me early shall find me. And wisdom is probably one of the greatest expressions of the Holy Ghost in the Old Testament. Someday I might minister on and show you the symbolism there. Oh, it's a better day. Hallelujah. Jesus, use us. Use me, Lord. And then all of a sudden it comes to a place that says, Lord, you have to use me. It's like, I got to see your glory or I'm going to die over here. You can't see my glory. No, I want to see your glory. You'll die. I don't care. I want to see your glory. Hear that? He was laying hold on God. He was doing exactly what Jacob did. Why don't you do what that? Why don't you follow the example? I can show you where Paul did it. I can show you where every man or woman that was ever used by God did it. They laid hold on God. Suddenly it wasn't passive anymore. Oh, Lord, well, whatever you want to do, I know, I'm just going to leave it to you. He's already told us what he wants to do. He's waiting to see how bold, how full of a demand that we're going to become. That's why he said concerning the neighbor who came and banged on his neighbor's door, saying, get up and get me something. I got some friends come over and I got no food. And the Lord said, he will not rise and give to him because he's friend, but he will rise and give to him because of his shameless boldness that demands. And he said, this is how you need to pray. This is the way I want you to act towards me. That's a depth of relationship, people. That's a depth of love. That don't come out of any other thing but love. I don't just come out of your head. That comes out of here. That comes out of intimacy with him. It comes out of communion. God wants that for you. And there's some things that you've got to decide. There's some things you've got to get straight. There's some things that we've got to put into place in our life. And that intimacy with them just is there. It's there right now. It's there. It's just you haven't really been accessing it. You see what I'm saying? Is the Lord providing good for you? Huh? He's a provider. He's the Lord your provider. He's the Lord your righteousness. He's the Lord your Savior. He's the Lord your healer. He's the Lord your every other thing too. Amen. Every all that you need. Every person in this place tonight, I want you to do something with me. Paul describes how we are to pray. This is the first epistle to Timothy. He said, lift up holy hands. When you pray, lift up holy hands. And you know what the scripture says? It says, let the lifting of my hands be like the evening sacrifice. It's a place where the flame of God is burning up an offering set upon the altar that belongs to him. It's a place of, Lord, whatever you ask of me and whatever you require of me, I happily do it. It's the place that the Lord brought Abraham to when he said, go sacrifice Isaac in the place that I'll show you. It's just taking everything near and dear to us. It's been affixed to our hearts. And we didn't even know it. We didn't even know it. It became affixed to our hearts. We didn't even know it. And it was meaningless things that were actually have worldly affections attached to them. Wasn't even at the level of Isaac. Wasn't even at the level. And tonight, Father wants to show the things to you. He's going to begin to speak to you. He's going to be ministered to you. He's going to show you how to lay down your line. He's going to show you how to be disinterested in yourself and captivated with him. That's right, baby. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you for the anointing in little Anna's life. How old was Anna one night in a meeting? She started saying hallelujah. She was 9 months old. She did not have the motor skills from a physiological perspective to say this, but she sat there saying hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And from that day, she said hallelujah all the way through until she became old enough to actually have the motor skills to say it, and then she quit saying it. It was a sign of wonder. It was true. It's true. It wasn't too long after that Ali took her into a doctor's appointment, and she's sitting in there going, hallelujah, hallelujah. And one was sitting there listening to her and said, is that baby saying hallelujah? Because she kept saying this over and over again. And Ali said, yes, and hallelujah. Just the Spirit of the Lord begins to, I mean, it's the expression of the Spirit of the Lord moving in a 9-month-old. She did not have to go in her thoughts and thinking, I don't want it to be me. Guess what? When the Holy Ghost begins to speak through you, it's going to be you. It's going to be you and the Holy Ghost. It's going to be the Holy Ghost giving you inspiration. It's going to be your tongue and mouth forming the words. It's going to be you and the Holy Ghost. And it will grow into something so powerful. Come on, people. Come on now. You get on your face and you start getting your place in God's presence defined. You start lifting up your voice for these United States of America and Southern California, especially San Diego, and God's gift of the abiding place to this region. You start lifting up your voice for Kashmir and for Sikkim and for Nepal and for Bhutan and all those places that we've been. That map out there is lit up with places that we've been that God has used us to go and do something in it. Minya, Colombia is on there. All the places that we've been that God has, we've done some kind of meaning crusade that God has somehow called us to, that there is a purpose and a draw of the Holy Ghost. You start laying it. Come on now. Come on now. You must get engaged. Must begin to get engaged. And if you will, the reward is immense. Dear Lord, the reward is amazing. It's like me standing here talking to you saying, listen to me. It's like you're in Papua New Guinea is one big gigantic gold mine. And here I would say to you, listen, start digging right where you're at. It's pure 99% gold. And the impurities are silver and platinum. And I'm standing there looking at you going, get the shovel and start digging right now. Don't look at me like, I can't believe he's putting this pressure on us. Put the egg. There's gold right under your feet. More than you can imagine. It's the mother lode. It's the father lode. They used to call them the glory hole. That's what I'm talking about. Engage. Because I believe that Satan, because of the way that things go on in this society, in this culture, will continually come and steal the seed of the Word of God, and you don't remember. And you meant to, but you forgot. And then you meant to, but you forgot. And you meant to, but you forgot. And you meant to, but you forgot. And it goes on that way until it becomes something that is completely inordinate. Start taking those things that the Lord gives you and start writing them out. Writing them out. Putting them before you. Marking. I got to go do this. I got to be this. I got to live this way. Holy Ghost, I want to live this way. Start talking to the Lord like this. Lord Jesus, I want to be what you've called me to be and purposed me to be. I want to be conformed to you. I'm tired of being conformed to the world and conformed to me. Amen.
Amen.
God demands that you glorify glorify him in your body, so get with the program. Hallelujah. I love how A.A. Allen was praying for a woman one night who was deaf. He said, now... He said you had faith and believed. Don't you disappoint us and not get healed. There had already been a blind person healed, person who couldn't stand up straight without a huge brace on their back. They had no muscular and structural ability to stand. And if they didn't have the brace, they could basically injure themselves so bad they'd be paralyzed for the rest of their life. He said, go take the brace off. They came out rejoicing on one person after another. And then this woman, he lays hands on this woman, she's standing there looking at him. He said, now you're just about to disappoint us. Get with the program. Don't come up here in the line and say you have faith to be healed. Stand there and look at us like nothing's happening. God laid hold on you for you to lay hold on him. That's Father's will. Father's will for you to be healed. Father's will for you to walk in all this goodness and all this glory of heaven. That's Father's will.
Yes.
I'll make Father's will something else when it's been fully revealed.
Jesus.
We love every one of you, but it's not as much as Jesus loves you. And you will never love God as much as he loves you. Ever. No matter how much you filled with the love of God, he'll still love you more. Because he loved you first. You'll never be as sold out to him as he is sold out to you. It's time to grab a hold of this people. Embrace the love of God. Start growing in it, maturing in it. Mm-mm-mm. Jesus. I'm really doing an altar call that right now that involves every single person in this place. God, the Holy Ghost is calling you to a change. He's calling you to a willingness to lay down your life for him as he laid down his life for you. He's calling you to a place of laying down your life for a lost and dying world around you. As he laid down his life for a lost and dying world, for you. And as you do that, I'm going to tell you right now, some things are going to begin to happen. You're going to begin to get some creative ideas about what we could do in ministry to see more people impacted. You know, I wanted to do an adult Christmas play outside last year. I shut down the Christmas plays because I didn't feel the anointing in it. I felt like it was just nothing but a bunch of entertainment. I said, no, I'm going to do this. I'm going to wait till somebody is able to begin to direct it to where there's an anointing of God in it. And then when the people come in, lost loved ones, it's the time to make sure that the power of God moves in such a way that every one of them is saved. And I could, you can't trample over the anointing, get up and think God's going to move. You hear what I'm saying? But I'm going to tell you, we begin to step over into this realm. I guarantee you, your lost loved ones, your friends, and your acquaintance are going to begin to be impacted by the Holy Ghost. And the things that we begin to do around here that everybody, no matter who you are, begins to do, is going to be done under the power of the Holy Ghost, and it's going to have a glory on it. And believe me, I don't get confused about the anointing. I know I can recognize the anointing. I can recognize the glory. I know when it's there and I know when it's not there. And we encourage people no matter where they're at. But I'm just talking about this can be easily solved in everybody's life. This can be easily fixed in everybody's life. You just need to get intimate with the Lord. You need to get resigned over to walk fully over into this place where he's called you to live. In Jesus' name. in the name of Jesus. You need to get, I want you to get big and bold and confident in Jesus. Amen. He's laid a hold on you that you may lay hold on him. Hallelujah. I'm not making an altar call about if there's anyone in the place that wants to surrender their life to the Lord. It's a command and a call. It's a shout from heaven, every one of you. Every person standing in this place, I take hold of your life by the power of the living God. In the name of Jesus Christ, for you to quit living compromised lives and conflicted lives. But in Jesus' name, for this day forward, to begin to lay hold on God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.